Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us at this hearing of the Committee on Governmental Operations. I'm Ben Kallos, chair of the committee. You can tweet me at Ben Kallos. We're joined today by committee members Antonio Reynoso and Carlos Menchaca. We're also joined by Fernando Cabrera, who is one of the sponsors of one of the bills. Today we're hearing 8 bills related to the Campaign Finance Board. We're also hearing 2 resolutions related to voting reforms that are carried in the Assembly by Assemblymember Brian Kavanaugh, who joins us today. Since the CFB's matching funds program was created in 1988, the Council has made continual improvements to strengthen it, from increasing the matching rate to sharply limiting donations by lobbyists. The Council has worked hard to account for new information and regulatory changes. The purpose of the public matching program is to incentivize positive behaviors like seeking out small dollar contributions over large contributions from special interests. In 2014, the Council passed 2 bills originating in this committee, sponsored by Council members Lander and Gorodnik, which improved disclosure of political spending by outside groups and improved transparency in our elections. Our system of providing public matching funds for small dollar donations is a national model that we can all be proud of. The Campaign Finance Board's post-election report, which comes out after each local election, is a key part of our efforts to keep the system strong. The CFB's most recent post-election report laid out a series of recommendations for legislation, and the 8 introductions we are hearing today stem from those recommendations. The first 4 of these bills I am proud to sponsor. Introduction 985A strengthens the city's pay-to-play law and prevents distribution of any public matching funds for money bundled by a lobbyist or a person who has or may have business dealings with the city. Those currently in the Doing Business database are also subject to stricter contribution limits of $400 for citywide offices, $320 for borough president, and $250 for city council. In 2013, 19% of all bundlers were doing business with the city and raised 24% of all bundled funds. The city should not be providing public dollars to amplify the already strong voices of special interests. Introduction 986 allows an earlier disbursement of limited amounts of public money to qualified candidates, shifting up the first possible disbursement by 6 weeks. Doing so allows campaign to plan more effectively and gives a candidate who runs into difficulties receiving funds enough time to resolve those issues. Introduction 987 creates a new formula to determine who can participate in the first mandatory CFB-sponsored debate for citywide offices. The proposed formula is a better measure of a candidate's viability and requires that candidates have raised and spent 2.5% of the expenditure limit rather than just raising 20% of the spending limit. Introduction 988 allows voters to opt out of receiving a hard copy of the voter guide, meaningfully decreasing the significant cost associated with the printing and mailing of the packet. It would also help save the environment as we round up after Earth Day. The bill also requires the CFB to take measures to improve public awareness of the candidates in contested elections for not just city office, but also for county, state, and federal offices. Introduction 980, sponsored by Councilmember Cabrera, equalizes contribution limits for transition and inauguration entities with campaign contribution limits for that office, which he will speak to shortly. Introduction 990, sponsored by Councilmember King, extends the prohibition on contributions from non-registered political committees to cover candidates who are not participating in the public matching program. This brings the standards for participating and not participating candidates more in line. Introduction 1001, sponsored by Councilmember Williams, increases transparency by requiring that any organization with greater than 10% ownership interest in entities doing business with the city, including, be included in the Doing Business database. Introduction 1002, also sponsored by Councilmember Williams, streamlines the process by requiring the Conflicts of Interest Board to maintain records of compliance with the annual disclosure requirements of the Conflicts of Interest Law, eliminating the requirement for candidates to submit a receipt to the CFB. Finally, we are hearing 2 pre-considered resolutions I am sponsoring relating to elections and voting, both with which Speaker Melissa Mark Viverito discussed in her State of the City speech in February. The first calls on the state to pass the Voter Empowerment Act, which would streamline voter registration. The second resolution calls for a constitutional amendment to establish no excuse absentee voting in New York State. These resolutions are in support of tireless advocacy by Assemblymember Brian Kavanaugh and Senator Gianaris at the state level. At this time, I'd like to invite other bill sponsors to say a few words, beginning with Councilmember Cabrera.
Thank you so much, Chair Kallos. And since I've known you, you have been truly a leader and a champion related to issues related to campaign finance board or anything related to campaigns. So good afternoon, and thank you again to Chair Kallos and to my colleagues on the committee for the opportunity to have my bill, Intro 980, heard today. I believe this bill will provide strong legal protection against corruption and excess spending. Currently, candidates elected to the office of mayor, public advocate, controller, borough president, or member of the city council are allowed to designate one or more entities other than political committees to accept donations and loans and to make expenditures for transition or inaugural into office. Candidates are not allowed to use their existing candidate committee or any other political committee or entity to raise money for transition or inauguration purposes. We are all familiar with the requirement that newly elected candidates who want to raise or spend funds for their transition or and or inauguration into office must create and register a transition and inauguration entity with the campaign finance board. This requirement applies to all the candidates elected into city office, regardless of participation into a campaign finance program. Intro 980, if enacted, will limit contributions for ties of TIEs of winning campaigns for local office at the same level as the campaign contribution limits for that office. It will also clarify that candidates do not need to set up separate entities if they wish to self-fund their transition and inauguration entity in part. The goal of this bill is to improve transparency and fairness by restricting the ability of candidates for public office from spending an exorbitant amount of money. As we all know, money has immense power over our government in many respects. Big money should not primarily dictate public policy. The needs of New Yorkers should. A responsive democracy is one in which the elite donor class that funds campaigns does not exercise more than its fair share of power. Introducing contribution limits at all levels of the political process will go a long way to creating a political system that is more accurately reflect the priorities of all the people and not just a small class of powerful, wealthy people. Thank you so much, Chair.
Thank you for being here and for advocating for your legislation. Councilmember Cabrera cares deeply for democracy and modernizing democracy and has a number of bills in this committee, and we're just thankful for his interest and his advocacy. Councilmember Williams is unable to be here, but asked that I read the following on his behalf. Chair Kallos, colleagues, committee staff, thank you for the opportunity to submit a brief statement in support of my bills. As you may know, I am home recovering from hernia surgery, but I wanted to have this statement of support read into the record. Pleased to be the prime sponsor of Introduction 1001 of 2015, which requires entities that have 10% or greater ownership stake in entities that conduct business with the city to be added to the doing business database maintained by the city. Individuals already included, the people of New York City have a right to know what private entities are doing business with the city and operate a third-party organization should not exempt them from disclosure. I'm also pleased to sponsor Introduction 1002, of 2015, which would require the Conflicts of Interest Board to maintain records of compliance with the annual Conflicts of Interest Law for candidates who participate in the city's public matching campaign finance program. These records would be provided to the Campaign Finance Board upon request. This system improves upon current conflicts of interest process, as currently candidates themselves are required to obtain a receipt of compliance from the Conflicts of Interest Board and provide such receipt to the Campaign Finance Board. All told, these two bills in larger package being heard today will increase transparency and good government, a hallmark of our democratic process. Thank you again, Chair Kallos and my colleagues. And I'm hoping that Councilmember Williams is watching the live stream from home. And if everyone can just join me in wishing him well, we wish you well, Councilmember Williams. Before we begin, I'd like to thank our committee counsel, Smita Deshmukh, Policy Analyst Lori Wen, Finance Analyst James Sabuti, and my Legislative Director, Paul Westrick, for their work on today's hearing. With that said, I'm going to call representatives from the administration as our first panel. Our second panel will be Assemblymember Brian Kavanaugh, followed by the Conflicts of Interest Board, followed by the Campaign Finance Board. I'd like to remind everyone who would like to testify today, please fill out a card with the sergeant. I'll ask those on the panel providing testimony or answering questions to please raise their right hand. Mr. Henry Berger, do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions?
Yes.
You may begin.
Good afternoon, Chair Kallos, council members. My name is Henry Berger. I'm special counsel to the mayor. Thank you for having me here today and for holding a hearing on these important issues. You have my written statement before you. I'm not going to read the whole thing. There are some points I would like to emphasize to save some time. The highly successful campaign finance program provides candidates with a strong incentive to finance their campaigns by engaging with average New Yorkers instead of seeking large contributions from special interest groups. In the 2013 election, more than 44,500 New Yorkers, half of all New York City contributors to participating candidates, made a contribution to a city candidate for the first time. Three quarters of them made small contributions of $175 or less. In the aftermath of Citizens United and other campaign finance decisions that have made it more difficult to regulate money in politics, advocates of campaign finance reform have turned to New York City as a model worth emulating in other cities and states. Before I discuss the specific legislation, I want to note again that CFB is nonpartisan, independent, and thus for many of these proposals and is in a better position to discuss the feasibility and practical implications. I'm glad that Amy LaPrest has joined us today to outline CFB positions. Nonetheless, I'm happy to share with you the administration's thoughts on some of these bills. In general, I note that the stated effective dates may have to be changed as some of those dates have already passed, and I'm sure that staff is well ahead of us on that. Intro 980, and I'll just go through the bills one at a time very quickly. Intro 980 would set contribution limits for transition and inauguration entities of winning campaigns for local offices at the same level as the campaign contribution limit for that office. It would also clarify that candidates need not set up separate entities if they wish to partially self-fund their TIEs. The administration is supportive of this amendment, which will help candidates streamline and simplify the transition process from candidate to elected officials. This amendment will ensure that no confusion regarding what a candidate can raise and spend during the transition period. Intro 985, currently those doing business with a city can only contribute up to $400 to a citywide candidate and cannot have their contributions matched. This intro would prevent lobbyists and those doing business with the city from matching with public funds any contribution to a candidate for local office that they have bundled from other candidates. This is an extra step to ensure that well-heeled lobbyists cannot indirectly bypass the intent of our regulations. The legislation will ensure that our fundraising process is fair, free from undue influence. The administration is supportive of this legislation. Intro 986 would allow for disbursement of limited amounts of public funds to qualifying candidates at an earlier stage in the election. It would change the earliest date for disbursement from following the finalization of candidates who qualify for ballots to shortly after the deadline for certification in the public matching program. This is a great proposal as it would help insurgent candidates secure resources needed to compete at an earlier stage and thus create a more fair and just system. The administration supports this proposal in concept. We note that the bill is drafted, particularly the section that removes language relating to the general election in section 4 may obscure the distinction between primary and general elections and may need to be clarified. Intro 987 would modify the standards for contributions raised and spent by candidates who participate in the city's public funding matching program in order to be eligible to participate in the first official debate for the office they seek. It would change the formula for eligibility from having to raise 20% of the threshold for public funding to to 2.5% of the expenditure limit for such office. This will make the initial debates more inclusive and fair, and we support this proposal. Intro 988, CFB will comment as to the feasibility of this proposal. Clarification to the text of the bill may be appropriate, particularly with respect to the proposal's intended relationship between the printed voter guide and other formats. Intro 980, under this proposal, candidates for local office who choose to participate in the city's public matching program may receive contributions from a political committee only if such committee has registered with the campaign finance board. However, candidates who choose not to participate in the matching program may accept contributions from political committees regardless of whether they are registered or not. This bill would extend the prohibition on the acceptance of contributions from non-registered political committees to non-participating candidates. The administration supports the change. Intro 1001 relates to requiring disclosure of entities that own entities that do business with the city. The administration supports this bill. There may be some technical corrections on the current draft. We note in this regard, and this is being very lawyerly, that the term person is already in the provision purported to be amended and is generally construed to include organization under the administrative code. So you may be able to simplify that. And under intro 1002, Julia Davis from the Conflicts of Interest Board is here, and she will comment on this bill. I would also like to take the opportunity to note that the current CFB proposals do not address CFB's longstanding reliance on post-election auditing and post-election enforcement procedures, which threaten the proper administration of public matching fund payments. We would like to discuss with the council legislation that would enable completion of CFB enforcement and payment determinations earlier in the election cycle. CFB's current deferral of all final enforcement actions creates an unduly burdensome and lengthy CFB post-audit election process. Indeed, the CFB did not even begin to issue final audit reports for the public fund recipients in the 2013 election until May 2015. Rather than piecemeal adjustment, we need a comprehensive overhaul to give every candidate a full and fair opportunity to respond to and timely resolve specific allegations before the election. No candidate should be deprived of any public matching funds he or she has earned on the basis of unresolved allegations. We look forward to working with the council on all these proposals, and I welcome any of your questions.
Thank you. We've been joined by Council Member Levine. And to be clear, the administration supports all eight of the bills.
We do, with a few technical corrections suggested.
Thank you. With regard to the legislation for limiting the bundling by lobbyists and people doing business with the city, in terms of that legislation, do you believe that that will further limit the influence of special interests in the city of New York, or what impact do you expect it to have?
We think it will have a significant impact. We've tried very hard. The council has, going back, I think, to the very beginning, has, well, not to the amendments when they limited those who were doing business and lobbying to smaller contribution limits. We think that made an impact, and this is the logical next step. You know, lobbyists play a number of roles in city government, some of which are very, very important. Their influence on the electoral process, as demonstrated in the 2013 campaign, is significant and can be reduced by this, and we think it is appropriate to do so.
With regard to the early funds payment, obviously there was a situation in the previous election cycle where a candidate made it pretty far into the process only to find out that they were not receiving funding. Do you think that would have an impact on similar situations? Do you think it would have an impact on the number of people who have access to the ballot?
No, I think there are two different issues here. As to the first issue, I think the piece I discussed at the end of my testimony, where there's a rolling, ongoing resolution of outstanding issues. Since candidates are now funding starting at the very beginning of the four-year cycle, having an opportunity to resolve those issues will make sure that candidates who are entitled to funding get the funding. For the situation where a candidate is running and trying to plan a campaign under the current procedures, funding isn't made available until the beginning of August. And in planning a campaign, it's nice to know that the money's going to be there and where it's there, and there are expenses that the campaign doesn't start at the beginning of August. The campaign starts earlier, and to give candidates the opportunity to have the funds to actually start their campaign in a timely fashion, we think will make the system more competitive. I know incumbents don't always like that, but having competitive elections throughout the process we think is important, and that's why we think this is such an important proposal.
With regards to Introduction 1001, I'll ask on behalf of Councilmember Williams. Do you have any examples, or do you think at least that the administration might support an expansion of 1001 to not only require the disclosure of the companies that own companies that own companies that do business with the city and the humans behind it, but to also put restrictions as those people having a doing business contribution limit?
I don't think we've actually reached that issue, so we don't have a position on it. I do know we had a lot of discussions about this issue when the last set of amendments came through on the disclosures of entities doing business, and we think it's a step in the right direction, but we would like to sit down and discuss with you what the next steps are on this.
Thank you. Councilmember Cabrera, do you have any questions? Perfect. On to Councilmember Reynoso.
Good afternoon, I guess, and thank you for being here. Just wanted to ask a question regarding intro number 987. We're going from, just I want to make sure that we're all clear, from 20%, let me get the right document out.
It's 20% of the threshold for public funding going down to 2.5% of the spending limit for that office.
Yeah, so the 20% to 2.5, it can be deceiving. So I just want to get clarity here. Which of the two is greater, the 20% or the 2.5%?
I believe the 2.5%, but CFB is here, and they get into those weeds much deeper than I do, and I think they can comment on that better than I can.
Okay, so I'm excited. I'll wait to see when they get here. My concern, of course, is folks that have opinions or want to participate in this process that have a hard time raising money or don't have strong networks get excluded from the system altogether. I don't know if we've seen the rent is too damn high is a perfect example of someone that might get excluded from a debate, and how much we enjoyed the entertaining moment of having him on board. But outside of that one, I have one more question, and that's in concern to no, sorry, he called me very early, so I wasn't prepared.
We can come back to you.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Councilmember Levine, followed by Councilmember Reynoso.
Mr. Berger, great to see you.
Good to see you, too.
You've expressed support for Intro 986, which would allow for earlier payment of some of the matching funds. I should know this, but does the legislation specify what portion of the matching funds would be paid out early, or is that left to be decided by CFB?
I'm not sure. I would ask Amy to. Amy, why don't you join me up here?
It's a set amount per office.
Square you in very briefly, and then we will, if you have specific questions on legislation, we will wait for CFB. Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions?
I do. For the record, I'm Amy Loprest, Executive Director of the Campaign Finance Board. In answer to Council Member Levine's question regarding the early payment of public funds, there would be a specific amount by office. So it would not be, it's written into the law, and I'm If I can turn to the right page, I will tell you the exact numbers.
10,000, 50,000.
So it's 250,000 for mayoral candidates, 125,000 for public advocate and controller candidates, 50,000 for borough president candidates, and $10,000 for city council candidates.
Very helpful. We are 3 years into this election cycle. I'm presuming that then this, your expertise is always welcome, Amy. I'm presuming that this would not apply to this current election cycle. The proposal would be for the 2021 cycle and, or special elections after 2017. Is that right?
Our recommendation is that they would be effective after the 2017 election.
And hold questions for CFP and just yeah. Let them come out later. And any questions specifically for the administration?
Yes. Okay, not wasn't adequately drawing the distinction there. I think I'll wrap it up with just thank you, Henry, for speaking on behalf of the administration and your, I think, universal support for this package. Wonderful to have your partnership in making the nation's best public financing system even better.
It's a good partnership.
Thank you.
Anyone else on first round before going back to Reynosa? Councilmember Reynosa.
Yeah, I had a hard time distinguishing whether or not my questions should go to the CFB or the administration, but I think they're going to go to the CFB, so I'll hold for those. And also want to acknowledge the fact that New York City has one of the best CFB systems in, I want to say, the entire country, but definitely in this state, and that we're always trying to take a step to do more. We're already doing the best, and we're still doing more. It's unfortunate that maybe other locations are not necessarily looking to take take example of the work that we're doing here. Thank you.
We should continue to aspire to perfection, and we'll get there.
Thank you.
Mr. Berger, you're excused. Thank you for your testimony. Next up is Assemblymember Brian Kavanaugh, followed by the Conflicts of Interest Board, followed by the Campaign Finance Board, followed by, I see we're joined by NYPIRG and Common Cause. For what it is worth, a lot of people have started to notice that our state election laws are broken. And a lot of people were purged or set inactive in Brooklyn. And in New York State, if you miss two federal elections and do not respond to one piece of mail, forget committing a crime, you lose your right to vote. That's that. People believe we should have permanent registration. I'm one of those people. There shouldn't be a way for you to really lose your right to vote. And in fact, committing a crime in many states isn't even a bar to voting. That is not necessarily required. And so as we are trying to make many of these changes for the city of New York, those changes need to happen in Albany. And the good news is we have a champion in Albany who has been fighting for this for as long as I've known him. And so Assemblymember Brian Kavanaugh, would you mind being sworn in? Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions? Perfect. And we would like you to speak on two resolutions we're passing, one on your Voter Empowerment Act of New York, A5972, as well as a resolution in support of A2644, which apparently doesn't have a Senate sponsor. We will get you, you will get us a Senate sponsor, do you? Perfect. Thank you.
Forgive me. We have different equipment in the state capitol. Again, I'd like to begin just by thanking all of you for being here and holding this very important hearing, and particularly and to return the praise of the chair of this committee. Ben Kallos has, as all of you know, I'm sure, been very thoughtfully and very consistently and very aggressively working to ensure that we focus on the need for changing the campaign finance laws like the ones you're talking about today, and also the laws around and procedures and policies and practices around administering our elections. I know you have, I think you're having some subsequent hearings on some of the nuts and bolts of what has happened in recent weeks in the administration of elections that's brought a lot of these issues to light, but I know that your committee has been working on them for a long time. I am a last-minute addition to your lineup here today. I apologize, I don't have formal testimony for you. On a normal schedule, we would be in Albany and not in New York City today, but since we are this week beginning tomorrow, I wanted to come and speak with you briefly because I'm very pleased that you are joining in pushing the legislation that we're speaking about today. Just generally speaking, we have an election system in New York that makes it difficult for voters and for people who administer the elections to participate in the system at every turn. We have not been the subject of some of the rather aggressive and intentional efforts to make it more difficult to vote in some other states. We have not instituted new draconian voter ID laws. We have not had active efforts, at least on the part of the government, to suppress registration in my from my perspective at least. But we have a system that is so antiquated and so difficult for people to get through that it has more or less the same effect. So while we might share the outrage of those who look at government officials trying to prevent people from voting, we also need to look at our own system and improve it so that we are doing everything we can to ensure that every person who wants to participate in our political process can do so. So we make it difficult initially for people to get on the list of people who are eligible to vote in the first place. We make it difficult to take that act initially. We also set very artificial deadlines on how and when you can take that step and get on the rolls. We schedule too many elections. We've added a couple in recent years. We also make the administration of poll sites on election day far too difficult for both both voters and for the workers. And finally, this whole system makes it too difficult for us to adapt to problems as they occur. It is very difficult in our system to correct mistakes. It is very difficult for the system to adapt, again, because it is antiquated and because it is unduly rigid. The two bills on your agenda that you're talking about today, one is called the Voter Empowerment Act, which is sort of an omnibus bill. It is the broadest piece of voter registration modernization, I think, anywhere in the country. It would take us basically through every improvement you can make legislatively without changing the Constitution in one bill. I'll talk more about the details of that in a minute. In addition, we're talking today about no excuse absentee voting. Currently, the state legislature has already taken the step of removing some previously existent, very artificial restraints that specified the kinds of reasons you had to be absent. We've eliminated those, but one still, under the constitution of the state, needs to be unavoidably absent from one's jurisdiction, in this case New York City, in order to vote. So if you can't make it to your poll site, but you're in the city somewhere, technically you're not permitted to take advantage of our current absentee voting system. This bill would eliminate those provisions and allow the legislature to set any reasonable conditions we need to. I would just want to mention also the City Council has a broad state agenda this year and has a few other election reform proposals that are relevant today. You have come to Albany in support of instant runoff voting, which would eliminate the second election in citywide elections. That's also a bill I carry, and again, a very important step because one of the things we've been experiencing is voter fatigue, where there's just more and more elections we're asking people to come back to. You've also, the City Council, through this committee, has come out in favor of early voting, which is a bill I carry and I expect we'll be seeing some action in Albany soon. The Assembly has passed it previously. We've revamped it and tried to address people's concerns. And you have come out in favor of eliminating the 10-day registration deadline for registering to vote, which again is a constitutional provision. I'm not here to speak today much about about the campaign finance issues, but your system in the city is exemplary, and you have also joined us in calling for closing the LLC loophole, which is something we've been trying for several years, and that's again part of the City Council's agenda, and I appreciate and commend you for that. So the two bills we have before us today, I'll do the second of them first. It's the most straightforward one. As I mentioned, it basically eliminates constitutional restrictions on when people can participate in
absentee voting. It provides what's sometimes called no-excuse absentee voting. Currently, the Constitution requires that you have you have an excuse and you need to be unavoidably absent, so it's up to the voter to determine whether their particular circumstance or their particular child care duties warrant that, and then they have to fill out a form to do that. By eliminating that from the Constitution, it would then allow us to act legislatively to remove any restrictions we have in statute. As the chair mentioned, this bill does not currently have a Senate sponsor. It does, however, have the advantage of having a separate Assembly bill carried by Assemblymember Jim Brennan, who has also been pushing this. And we have been working with Jim Brennan and with the chair of our committee, Mike Cusick, to move this forward this year, and I expect we will with your help. The Voter Empowerment Act, as I mentioned, is an attempt to really clear away the full range of restrictions that are in our current registration laws. It begins, the first experience people have with the registration system is typically before their 18th birthday, or at least their first opportunity to do so, because many people are presented with the opportunity to register at departments of motor vehicles. The bill begins with what is called youth pre-registration. This is on the books in many states, and it basically allows the Department of Motor Vehicles or other agencies registering voters, including high schools, to pre-register, meaning collect all the information necessary to register. The board then verifies that at the 18th birthday, and the person automatically becomes registered. There's a very limited ability to register people very shortly before their 18th birthday in the current law. This greatly expands that. The bill calls for an online voter registration system. You may have noted that the Attorney General of the state of New York recently ruled in response to questions from the Suffolk County Board of Elections that it is technically permissible to allow a registration to be done without what is called a wet signature, a signature in ink. However, the process that the Attorney General has determined is legal based on current law is still a pretty clunky process. He ruled that the signature can get onto the piece of paper in an electronic way, but then the piece of paper still needs to be mailed in many circumstances. So it's not a fully online system that he's made legal. I think it's a very big step and a very positive step that the Attorney General has done that, but we ought to go ahead and create a straight up online registration ability that boards of elections can implement directly at the state and at the city level. We have the bill also calls for again reducing those registration deadlines to the constitutional minimum. You have, as I mentioned before, the council and many of us in the Assembly agree we ought to eliminate the constitutional restrictions, but the Constitution currently says that you can register up to 10 days before the election. The Voter Empowerment Act addresses that by moving the deadlines, which are currently 25 days. It varies depending on which election, but the longest of them is 25 days, moving all of those deadlines to 10 days so that, you know, in the case of this year, on April 9th, you still could have registered for the April 19th primary rather than a day in March. It eliminates the provision that got a great deal of attention this year that dates from the 19th century that requires that if you want to change your party, you do it in the year preceding the election. So this year it was a date in October that applied to the April 19th presidential primary. It also is that date in October that applies to our September primaries this year. So you had to decide nearly a year in advance that you want to participate in this year's primary. It disadvantages, sort of oddly, people who have the misfortune of having previously registered to vote over people. It puts those people in a worse situation than people who have not registered and are just showing up for the first time. So this bill would, again, take that date and push it to the constitutional minimum date, make it the same date as the date to register. In the case of this bill, that's 10 days. Finally, it deals with a couple of fairly technical issues. Currently, registrations, if the Board of Elections becomes aware that somebody moves within the jurisdiction, they can transfer the registration directly, but not across county lines. So when somebody moves from Yonkers to the Bronx or the Bronx to Yonkers, that registration process starts from scratch. This bill would eliminate that and allow those registrations to be automatically transferred. Finally, this bill, as I mentioned, does not technically provide for same-day registration, but it does give a lot of the advantages that come with same registration in that it explicitly provides if somebody has attempted to register and can show that, they are able to correct any defects in the registration record and still cast a regular ballot on election day. One advantage of same-day registration, of course, is that somebody can wake up that morning and decide, you know, I think I'm ready to vote, and they can get out there and they can register and vote. That benefit cannot be provided without a constitutional amendment. But in many cases, you're dealing with voters who are showing up at the poll site. They believe themselves to have been registered. They, in fact, could even demonstrate they've been registered, and there may well be a record in the possession of the Board of Elections that corroborates that. But because the registration was not correctly recorded, it was ineffective, and then they can't vote. All of these changes, if implemented, and I will note that there are standalone bills on each of these as well, so we may end up negotiating somewhat in the coming session, the latter part of the session in Albany. But all of these changes collectively are intended to push out there into the world clearly the notion that the state legislature and the assembly and the Senate, as well as the City Council and others who support these changes, are really committed to the notion that we're designing the system in order to encourage rather than discourage voting. In addition to benefiting voters enormously, these kinds of changes will make it far easier to administer the system itself. And I mentioned the inflexibility of it at this point, that is inherent in the system at this point. Partly that's because the rules are so rigid that election workers, even trying their best, can't fix problems often because deadlines have passed, because the system that they're administering is just too clunky. A lot of that comes from errors and logistical issues that I'm sure you'll explore in future hearings, but a lot of them are imposed on the boards by the state laws themselves, and that's why we're here to change them. Thank you. I think that's my testimony, and I'm happy to take any questions you have.
Thank you. Thank you, Assembly Member. Big fan of the Voter Empowerment Act. Just disappointed that it is 2016, and we are still trying to get some of these changes. Beyond passing this resolution, what else can the City Council or the City of New York do to support passage of this legislation before June 30th of this year?
Well, I would say that there is, you know, hope springs eternal, but there is, I think, an unusual level of attention right now to the notion that these laws need to be corrected. And I think what we need, candidly, is public pressure. And all of you have constituencies and organizations you work with to get the message out. We have till June 16th when the session ends. And I think it is important that my colleagues in the Assembly and our colleagues in the Senate, which you may know is currently controlled by the a Republican majority, some of whom are colleagues here in the city. But I think it's important that we get the message out that these changes really are necessary and that we should be changing them. It is not, sometimes these things are partisan, but often they are resisted by the party establishment in each of our parties. And as elected officials, we are, of course, part of that establishment, and it's important that we make sure that we are sending the message to the public and to organizations that we work with and to the leaders of our legislative bodies and our parties that we are prepared to compete in a system that is genuinely open to voter participation.
Would there be any impact on the 100,000 or so people who may have been disenfranchised in Brooklyn turning out in the next assembly election to let their elected officials know that this is of paramount importance to them throughout Brooklyn and even sharing that throughout the state and getting all, the voter file has 16 million people in it right now, if all those 16 million people actually made their voices heard and said that they want their right to vote protected by their electeds? And so that might be a change for most of them who are voting for president, but we now need them to vote for assembly too.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, I think it's important that the story of what went on in those purges be fully explored, and you know there are several investigatory processes that are going on. But it's important for people to understand there is a understandable concern that some sort of a conspiracy was mustered to remove those particular people to affect the outcome of the election. The message I think we need to get across to people is that this system is broken in ways that are predictable, in ways that have to do with the rules, and don't have necessarily have to do with people sort of engaging in dirty tricks behind the scenes at the boards of elections. If we open up the process and we make it clear to people that we have solutions for these problems, I think that we have a real shot of changing the laws in a way that will reduce the likelihood of that sort of thing occurring. And again, part of the problem that obviously seems to have resulted, according to news reports, from an error at the board, a clerical error perhaps. Again, that's going to be fully explored. But having people purged from the rolls in advance is not that big a problem if they can simply show up at the poll site and register and vote. The problem that enormous error was compounded by the fact that in our election system, if you're not registered to vote, there's nothing the Board of Elections or anybody else can do about it. So how we undo that and give those people their rights after the fact is an incredibly important question. But the simple fact is, in a different set of laws, it would not have been such a big problem. It would have been an administrative headache.
I think anyone who's interested in learning more, they can visit votersearch.org/demographics. I did an audit. I threw it up online. It took a couple of hours. And a lot of the people were actually purged in 2015 before the last November general, with still a significant number of people purged since the last general. But it's a key concern with regard to online voter registration and changing the deadline. So on anyone who's looked at a voter registration form, the deadline is 25 days. The state constitution says it's only 10 days, which means feasibly if people are doing online do you believe online voter registration would help and assist with changing the deadline from 25 days to 10 days as part of your Voter Empowerment Act?
I think a well-designed online registration system would change and improve every aspect of the registration process. If the data is put in by the voter on a screen that they can read and verify, and directly electronically transmitted to the people who have to then get it on the voter rolls without transcription, without people trying to read the handwriting on stacks of handwritten forms, I think that would have an enormously beneficial effect on all of this, and certainly will make it easier for boards of elections to administer deadlines that are close to the election day, and indeed, again, what I would favor is allowing people to register right up to the election day.
Thank you. Does anyone on the committee have questions for Assemblymember Brian Kavanaugh? Councilmember Menchaca.
Good afternoon, Assemblymember Kavanaugh. And I just wanted to, again, thank you for all the work you're doing out there. And clearly there's a lot of solidarity here, and we're going to continue that push in light of the recent issues that we're talking about. Can you give us a sense about who, and maybe we can stay in Brooklyn, because that's definitely where I want to start my advocacy. Is there anybody in Brooklyn that's not supporting yet, that's still, you know, mulling it over and thinking about it? It'd be great. I'm trying to figure it out on the website right now, but if you can just tell me where I can begin the advocacy.
I don't think I want to sort of out colleagues as not having put their name on this bill yet.
I think that's where we got to start.
Thank you for all,
that's just my
for your
style.
Advocacy. But the way our legislative process works, our calendar works, is we do the budget until April 1st. That is the primary activity of the first half of our year, and then we've now been on break through Passover, and we are back in session tomorrow through June 16th. So I think it's fair to say there is going to be a big push now for addressing these things. I would also note that some of these bills have been moved in the past. I mentioned early voting. The Assembly has passed that twice with an overwhelming majority of members of both parties voting for it. So these are not new ideas, and it's not like there's some anti-reform caucus that's blocking them. I just think that Albany is a place where it is challenging to get change done. And I think that people, prioritize things they think may be challenging and worthwhile, but within the realm of the doable. I think the way to make sure that these things are within the realm of the doable is to pressure members of the legislature in both parties to view this as something that is not, it's not just another set of reforms. You know, people grumble around Election Day, but then we forget, and then we wait till the next Election Day, and people are reminded of the problems. I think if you all and we all stay focused on this, we can build support for these ideas. I think it was mentioned earlier, I don't know if that was on the record or not, but the CFB and the Voter Assistance Commission of the City of New York and other organizations are bringing many, many people to Albany to make this point tomorrow. That kind of effort, which I encourage you all, I think it's not too late to get your name on the list and maybe get on one of the buses, but that kind of effort where we get large numbers of people to remind elected officials and others that this is something that, that regular people really care about, because sometimes people think reform is a secondary concern to some of the, you know, the economic issues and the other issues we deal with. But I don't think there's any magic, and there's no, I don't want to say there's a particular person that is blocking these. I will say it has been more challenging in the Senate majority with some of these things than the Assembly. But we're working, the intent is to work with both parties and try to get it done.
Well, then that is the intention, and that was the intention of the question as well, just to make sure we can start with folks that I think would be helpful, and we'll start in Brooklyn.
Great.
I think there's members on this committee that might want to join in partnership for that kind of work, and it'd be great to work with your offices as we lay the foundation. But I think one of the more impactful statements you made, out of the many, honestly, that you presented, it's worth repeating. The purging that happened, that's a routine in so many ways, but was really highlighted in this most recent presidential primary, could all be fixed if we have these other bills in place and on the books. And I think that's the message that I want to take to my community in South Brooklyn.
Great.
So thank you.
Thank you.
I would advise my colleagues to take a look at A5972 on the Assembly website. And if your Assembly members are not there, ask them to sign on as co-sponsors or multi-sponsors, just as our constituents do with us, with each other's bills. And what I will say is I will ask my Assembly members to sign on to your bill. I imagine that my senator is already signed on to, to Giannaris's bill, and I guess it's hard for me not to ask, Brian. You may defer, but you mentioned there is no anti-reform caucus out there, but I feel like there's this body out there that might be obstructing it, unless you feel that your companion bill in the Senate is all set. You don't have
I'm not
to
sure
answer.
That was a question, but I feel like we're on Jeopardy. It's the second round, so it has to be phrased in the form of a question. No, I think it, again, there. The status quo is often the status quo for a reason, and obviously sometimes there's resistance. Our intent is to overcome it and not blame people for past failures, but to move forward and try to push people of both parties in both houses to get these things done, because we do think there's a real significant desire on the part of the general public.
Thank you. Anyone else? Councilmember Reynoso.
What would this change do to party affiliation changes? If you were to show up the day of and wanted to, is it just new registrants, or would it be anyone can change their party on the same day?
Yeah, there are two distinct issues here. The first is that the registration deadlines for all people are too early. And we should move them up again. We should immediately legislatively move them to 10 days before the election, because that's what the Constitution permits. And then we should also change the Constitution, which is a longer process. It requires this legislature and then the next legislature to pass the constitutional amendment to do that. But we should make those changes. There is a separate standalone provision of the election law that should be repealed, and that provision says that your registration does not take effect from basically, I believe it's 25 days before the general election. It doesn't take effect until after the next general election. So that October deadline applies. The October 2015 deadline applies to all registration changes until this November 2016 election. So you could fix each of these problems separately. I would argue you should fix them both. But the standard should be, and the standard in the Voter Empowerment Act, is that the deadline for changing your registration is the same as the deadline for registering from scratch. And so you ought to be able to change from no party to a party, or from one party to another party, or from a party to no party, just as you might register from scratch.
So, but nothing we have right now in the Constitution or changes that you would be recommending or asking for. Do we have Well, I guess it would fix both problems. I guess what I'm trying to say, or trying to understand, is there also going to be an opportunity to change party at the same time that you register to vote?
Yes. Okay. You could change, again, if you're registering for the first time, you're designating a party from scratch. If you are currently registered, again, under the current law, you can change your address, you can change a lot of things about your registration up to the registration deadline, but you can't change your party if you don't do so in the year before. So this bill, and also a standalone bill I have, would eliminate that provision and just say you can change your party registration up to the same deadline that a brand new voter can register.
All right, thank you.
As the Progressive Caucus Love Fest continues, Councilmember Brad Lander.
First, let me say thank you, Mr. Chair, for convening this hearing on this really important set of bills I'm proud to be a co-sponsor on most of, so thank you for your leadership. It's obviously a very important time.
We already passed your bill. That would have been in the package.
Hey, look, it's obviously a critically important time to be focusing on doing absolutely everything that we possibly can. And I know you have some additional legislation that I'm excited about that I think would go even further to strengthening our campaign finance laws. And you and I have talked about some additional conflicts law amendments that would go further in strengthening our conflicts laws. So I'm supportive of all these things and appreciative of them. I hear you mention this before I got here, but I don't know if you saw. I saw yesterday, not you know, someone as of no less eminence than Amartya Sen, you know, Nobel Prize winner, is saying, based on watching this presidential election, that the time for ranked choice or instant runoff voting has come. So though that's not on today's item, I know it's a passion we share, and hopefully we'll be able to make that a reality for New York before
long. Right, and I did mention it before you arrived, and note that it is on the council's state legislative agenda this year. And I should mention also, I mentioned that one of the basic problems is we have too many elections. There are too many times we're getting voters to come. One of them the Councilmember Lander is referring to, which is our separate runoff system, which is really the only way to do a runoff if you have lever machines, like we did when that bill was passed. But one of the benefits of optical scanning machines with paper ballots ought to be that people should be able to designate their second choice on the day of the election, and then if a runoff is necessary, the runoff can be run by rescanning ballots and determining the outcome that way. That would save a lot of money. It would save about $10 to $12 million perhaps in a citywide election, but it also is part of a broader effort to make it less cumbersome on our voters to participate in the process. I should note the other example of that is the fact that we have been running separate state and federal primaries for a few years now because the Senate and the Assembly have not been able to agree on a date to consolidate them, and because the current September state primary date is too late to meet federal law. So we've been having a June primary for the Congress and a September primary for the Senate and the Assembly. That has caused a great deal of confusion every even year, and also is just another example where if you really want to participate, you got to come back again and again. So I am hoping that's something also that we can work on consolidating. But yeah, the instant runoff voting is something we're very committed to as well.
And I'll just underline, I mean, in addition to its time and money saving and not having to have so many elections values, the goal of having people see the system as genuinely majoritarian, that it doesn't have the opportunity, as we've seen in some places around the country in the presidential races, but that as we've also seen here in our special elections for city council and our primaries, that you can elect candidates with very small percentages of the vote, which may mean that they're not well known, or which may mean they're extreme or fringe candidates, and that that ranked choice gives us that majoritarian strength.
Right. And well. the bill we have now, there are two bills on this. The bill we've been pushing initially is to replace the existing citywide separate day runoff with a instant runoff that's done in a single day. I also have a bill I've worked on for a number of years with Senator Liz Krueger that would allow piloting of that concept in many other elections. And I know the City Council has Councilmember Lander have pushed for broader use of that concept in city elections, and I think
there's enough actually on today's calendar. I don't want to take up any more time with things that are not, but thank you for your leadership in Albany and your partnership with us.
Thank you. Any more questions? Thank you, Assemblymember. If anything, you've picked up a couple more sponsors for Assemblymembers who will be getting calls from their council members asking them to sign on, and whatever we can do to pass beyond this resolution, we hope to pass this soon, and we hope that this resolution carries weight in Albany. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next panel will be Julia Davis from the Conflicts of Interest Board, and then for the main event with Amy Lopress from the Campaign Finance Board. I want to thank the Conflicts of Interest Board for all the hard work that they do. They get at least one phone call a week from my office as we try to make sure we abide by every single rule. And as your counsel has advised, we often ask about angels dancing on the heads of pins on top of other angels. But that being said, it is grateful to have a resource such as yours to help keep us in line. And also thank you for working with us on the filings done by thousands and thousands of New York City employees and working with us to get those put online, which I told you back in 2009 we would get done, but it took 7 years. if I could swear you in, do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions?
I do.
Thank you. You may begin.
Good afternoon. My name is Julia Davis. I'm the Director of Annual Disclosure and Special Counsel for the New York City Conflicts of Interest Board. Accompanying me is the board's Executive Director, Carolyn Lisa Miller. We are here to offer testimony on Introduction 2015-1002, which would eliminate the requirement that the Conflicts of Interest Board provide candidates seeking matching funds from the Campaign Finance Board with a written receipt indicating proof of compliance with Section 12110 of the Administrative Code of the City of New York, and instead require the board to maintain a list of all candidates in compliance with Administrative Code Section 12110. We support this change in the law as improving a requirement that is often overly burdensome to both participating candidates and COIB staff. The change will mean the candidates will no longer have to ensure that a paper receipt be physically transferred from COIB to the Campaign Finance Board. It will also mean that COIB staff will no longer be required to prepare a paper receipt for every participating candidate, an especially onerous endeavor when, as in 2013, there are many open city elections. We do not envision the additional staff time needed to maintain these lists as onerous. Since we are talking about candidates and their filing requirements, I take this opportunity to bring to the council's attention an issue in the city's annual disclosure law that we believe needs to be addressed. Section 12110B2A requires that candidates file an annual disclosure report, quote, on or before the last day for filing his or her designating petitions pursuant to the election law, end quote. This creates a catch-22 situation. Since COIB cannot learn who has submitted designated petitions until after the deadline for filing them has passed, it cannot notify candidates of their obligation to file such a report until they are already out of compliance. This is patently unfair, especially to those candidates unable to afford experienced campaign staff. I invite the council to remedy this issue by fixing a deadline for the filing of annual disclosure reports by candidates that would enable COIB to notify candidates of their filing obligation with sufficient time for compliance, but would not undermine requirements and schedules of either the Campaign Finance Board or the city's Board of Elections. In conclusion, this bill would streamline the communication between COIB and the Campaign Finance Board concerning candidates' compliance with filing requirements, as well as ease the burden on candidates for complying with these requirements. As such, COIB supports it. Thank you, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
That's enough. Thank you. Your request has been accepted. To all the other council offices that are watching right now, we're putting in the LS request right now, so hopefully we'll gain priority. We will see what happens. And thank you for your testimony. I think, just full disclosure, I'm an attorney. I'm very aware with the campaign finance system and Conflicts of Interest Board, and even I missed one of the deadlines and had to go through a lot of difficulty trying to send somebody at the right time, especially if you're working full time while running for office, to then go down. I believe to get a copy of that certification, I had to fill out a separate piece of paper authorizing them to obtain it on my behalf, almost as close as a power of attorney. Then they got it and then had to drop it off at the campaign finance board, make sure it got certified that we got the receipt. I think the first time the person didn't get the receipt, it may have gotten into the round file at CFP. So all of this would be incredibly better to do electronically and between the two agencies rather than trying to pull folks into it. So we will accept the recommendation. And does anyone have any questions for Conflicts of Interest Board? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'd like to now call up Amy Loprest from the Campaign Finance Board. And if the other members of the team who may ask questions can also identify themselves, if everyone could say their name and title, and then I will swear or affirm all of you in.
Swear me again.
I need names from everyone first.
Okay. I'm Amy Loprest. I'm the executive director of the New York City Campaign Finance Board.
I'm Eric Friedman. I'm assistant executive director for public affairs of the New York City Campaign Finance Board.
I'm Sue Ellen Dodell. I'm the general counsel.
Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions?
I do.
You may begin.
Good afternoon, Chair Kallos and members of the Government Operations Committee and Councilmember Lander. I'm Amy Loprest, Executive Director of the New York City Campaign Finance Board. With me today are Eric Friedman, Assistant Executive Director for Public Affairs, and Sue Ellen Dodell, General Counsel. I want to thank the chair for his leadership on these issues and the members of the committee and the members who have sponsored the legislation we will be discussing today. I would also like to thank the staff of the council and the CFB who have collaborated on these bills that will strengthen the foundation of New York City's campaign finance program for future elections. If you're following the campaign for president, you've heard a sustained and substantive discussion about the role of money in national politics. Several of the candidates have spent considerable time decrying the role that money plays in the political process. It is instructive to note that none of these candidates have chosen the existing public financing program for presidential elections. The last candidate to win a major party nomination while participating in the presidential public financing program for the primaries was Al Gore in 2000. The last general election candidate to win the presidency using the system was George W. Bush in 2004. Candidates abandoned the system because it can no longer support a modern campaign for president. Congress created the program in 1974 and has left the framework untouched during the four decades since. It is fair to say that the business of political campaigning has changed considerably since the 70s. While campaigns evolved to embrace cable TV, the internet, and modern targeting tools, and candidates started campaigning earlier and earlier, the presidential public financing system has remained stuck in the disco era. By contrast, New York City's program, created nearly 30 years ago, has remained a vital component of the city's political system. We are required by our governing statute after each citywide election to review the impact of the matching funds program upon the conduct of election campaigns in the city and to recommend changes to the law. Our post-election report for the 2013 elections, published in September 2014, put forward the proposals we will be discussing today. City lawmakers have regularly refreshed and updated the program, ensuring it stays relevant as city campaigns and elections evolve. This council has acted decisively to strengthen disclosure of the funding sources for independent expenditures after outside spending flooded the 2013 city elections. At the same time, the council took action to ban anonymous communications so that voters can identify the sources of messages they receive. The CFP supported these proposals. As a result of the council's ongoing commitment to help the CFB improve the act, participation in the public financing system has remained high over the years. More than 90% of candidates on the ballot in 2013 primary elections chose to join the program. The matching funds program provides every candidate with the opportunity to access sufficient resources to get their message before the voters. It ensures that access to wealth is no guarantee of electoral success. Matching funds help participating candidates create a broad base of support. Research shows clearly that individuals from every neighborhood in every borough are investing their small contributions in city campaigns. This foundation helps ensure that the city's diverse voices have an opportunity to be heard here in City Hall. We appreciate the opportunity to partner with the council to help ensure the program continues to best serve the public and the candidates who choose to participate. It is important to note that there is much we are doing on our own to ensure the program is prepared to meet the challenges that future elections will bring. We are implementing several projects that will further simplify compliance with program's requirements while maintaining our commitment to the rigorous oversight the public has come to expect. Last month, we released NYC Votes Contribute, a first-of-its-kind online contribution platform available to all city candidates. NYC Votes Contributes collects all the necessary data from contributors, connects directly to the CFB's disclosure software, automatically generates all documentation and record-keeping required by our rules, and transmits it directly to the CFB. To use the platform, campaigns can embed the contribution tool on their own website or direct contributors to their candidate page on www.nycvotes.org. There are already 27 active campaigns using NYC Votes Contribute, and through today, they have raised more than $10,000 through the platform. Development will continue through the year in response to user feedback. Between now and the 2017 elections, we have plans to strengthen and improve all the systems that connect our work to candidates and to the public. This includes our disclosure software, C-Smart, which will have an improved and streamlined user interface and an expanded capacity to receive and organize backup documentation electronically. We have begun to offering a broader range of candidate trainings in new formats, including online webinars and new voluntary one-on-one candidate consultations for campaigns that have submitted at least one disclosure statement. We are continuing to work through our enforcement process for candidates in the 2013 elections. We're meeting the deadlines in the Campaign Finance Act to complete our audit work and match the pace we set for the 2009 audits. Our thorough audit reviews show that the majority of candidates are successfully navigating our system in substantial compliance with the Act and rules. More than half of the audits that have gone before the board to date have contained no penalties, and nearly two-thirds of all candidates finished with penalties under $1,000. Beyond these projects, we have identified several changes that require legislative action. The bills before the committee today will help modernize the program. They will remove outdated or unnecessary requirements the law imposes on campaigns, help candidates better plan their campaigns, and importantly, they will strengthen the law's protection against the influence of pay-to-play. We urge the committee and the council to approve them. I'm not going to go in the numerical order, in order of what we consider importance. Intro 986, first, will allow the board to make payment determinations for candidates earlier in the election year, which will help provide participating candidates with greater certainty about their public funds payments well before they enter the crucial final weeks of the election season. Under the Act, candidates must be on the ballot to qualify for public matching funds. This requirement prohibits payments to participating candidates until petitioning process ends and the ballots are set. As a result, candidates who qualify for the first payment may receive funds no earlier than 5 weeks before the primary. The timing of payment determinations can make planning difficult for some campaigns. Candidates who fail to qualify for public funds at the earliest date have limited time during the busiest weeks of the election cycle to resolve the issues preventing their payment. An earlier payment date would provide campaigns with the incentive to qualify earlier and provide opportunities to fix compliance issues in a timely way. The bill would allow payments as early as 4 days after the June 10th certification deadline for candidates who meet the threshold by the May 15th disclosure statement. To protect against the possibility of large payments to candidates who subsequently failed to make the ballots, these early payments are capped: $250,000 for mayoral candidates, $125,000 for public advocate and controller candidates, $50,000 for borough president candidates, and $10,000 for council candidates. For comparison, a mayoral candidate who has met the threshold, which is $250,000 in matching eligible contributions, would have qualified for a total payment of at least a minimum of $1.5 million. Council candidates who meet the minimum threshold qualify for a payment of at least $30,000. Initial research suggests that the danger of paying candidates who meet threshold but fail to earn a place on the ballot is small. In 2013, there were no candidates running in the primary election who had disclosed contributions sufficient to meet the threshold through May 15th and subsequently failed to make the ballot. However, Intro 986 also requires that candidates who receive an early payment but fail to campaign for office must return public funds they receive. Because we are now in the middle of the third year of the four-year election cycle, we urge the council to amend the bill so that it takes effect only for elections after 2017. Intro 985. Contributions from people who are doing business with the city government are strictly limited. Lobbyists, contractors, grantees, and other business doers may give no more than $400 to a mayoral candidate, $320 to a borough president candidate, and $250 to a city council candidate. Yet the law allows those same individuals to bundle unlimited amounts to the same candidates, a loophole that undermines the intent of the law to prevent or limit the appearance of pay-to-play corruption. Lobbyists, developers, contractors, and others who must observe the strict doing business limits can bundle contributions for many times what those limits allow them to give directly, and they do. Of the top $10 intermediaries from the 2013 election cycle, six were listed in the doing business database. Those contributions should not be matched with public funds. Intro number 985 will make these contributions non-matchable, which will limit their impact and decrease the potential for quid pro quo corruption that may be associated with potential city contractors or lobbyists who bundle contributions for candidates. An analysis of campaign disclosures from the 2013 elections shows that bundlers are significantly more likely to be doing business with the city than contributors overall. Individuals in the doing business database account for 19% of all intermediaries, but just 2% of all contributors. In the 2013 elections, more than $203,000 in contributions were bundled by someone doing business in the doing business database and claimed for matching funds. If intro number 985 had been in place, an estimated $1.2 million in public matching funds would not have been dispersed to campaigns. In the 2017 elections to date, more than $29,000 in matching claims reported by campaigns have been bundled by someone doing business with the city government. The potential impact on matching funds payments to date in 2017 elections is more than $176,000. The disparity in the total suggests that passing Intro 985 now should have a significant impact on fundraising for the 2017 elections, as most bundling activity we expect to see in 2017 is yet to occur. New York City's law has some of the strongest and broadest restrictions on pay-to-play at any level of government. This legislation is an important measure that will strengthen those limits even further. Intro 990. Candidates who opt out of the matching funds program must observe the same contribution limits as participants. They may also observe the ban on corporate contributions. These requirements for non-participants were upheld in 2013 in McDonald versus New York City Campaign Finance Board. The act allows participating candidates to accept contributions from political committees only if they are registered with the board. In registering, political committees affirm that they will not use money from prohibited sources, like corporations, to make contributions to candidates. Intro 990 will ensure that participants and non-participants alike will observe this requirement. Intro 1002. Candidates for public office in New York City are required to file personal financial disclosures with the COIB. To be eligible to receive funds, the Act directs participating candidates to provide paper receipt to the CFB indicating the disclosure has been filed with the COIB. The disclosure requirement should and will continue as a condition for public funds eligibility. However, Intro 1002 will eliminate this paperwork burden of notifying the CFB from candidates. Intro 988, the CFB prepares and prints a voter guide for all regularly scheduled elections in which there are contested races for mayor, public advocate, comptroller, borough president, or city council, and in years that there are local referenda are on the ballot. The charter requires the CFB to print and distribute a guide to each household with a registered voter before each primary and general election. New Yorkers expect resources for election information that provide the same interactivity and convenience they have in their everyday lives. More and more, they are relying on laptops, smartphones, and tablets to access information to help them make their choices on election day. The CFB's online guide has become a vital resource for many of those voters. To the extent feasible, Intro 988 will allow New Yorkers who prefer to access the guide electronically to opt out of receiving the guide in the mail. The bill offers the potential to reduce our reliance on paper and decrease the most significant costs of the voter guide, printing and postage. Intro 987. Courts have consistently upheld the constitutionality of limiting participation in debates to candidates who meet objective, nonpartisan, and non-discriminatory standards. Pursuant to Local Law 58 of 2004, the Act maintains basic minimum criteria for participation. Candidates must raise and spend more than one-fifth of the threshold for public funding, demonstrating that they have achieved a minimal level of support. The thresholds for debate participation have not changed, even as spending limits have increased more than 20% over the same period of time. An increased standard tied to the expenditure limit is a better objective indicator of viability. The board proposes that candidates should be required to raise and spend 2.5% of the expenditure limit for the office they seek. Other clarifications to debate law would provide certainty for candidates and the public. For instance, the law should be clear that outstanding liabilities and loans do not count toward debate eligibility. The requirements should be uniform for participants and non-participants. Anyone who has paid attention to the ongoing presidential race has experienced the challenge of producing debates that are both informative and engaging. Intro 987 will provide the CFB the ability to help debate sponsors produce compelling debates that best serve the needs of New York City voters. Intro 1001. As noted above, individuals with ownership interests in entities doing business with the city government are covered by doing business limits. It is not uncommon, however, for business entities to be owned by other business entities, especially in real estate. In these cases, neither these entities nor the individuals who control them are listed in the doing business database. These shell companies can obscure the identities of the firm's ultimate owner and decision maker. As a result, the individual who controls the firm doing business with the city may be shielded from coverage by the lower, more restrictive contribution limits in the Act. Intro number 1001 will require that doing business entities report not only the names of their own officers and owners, but also those of any entity with a significant ownership interest. Intro 980. Legislation passed before the 2001 election allowing candidates to create transition inaugural entities ties set the contribution limits for those entities identical to those for campaigns. Pursuant to the Act, campaign contribution limits were increased by 10% in 2002 to reflect changes in the Consumer Price Index, but tie contribution limits were not changed. Amendments to the Act over the years have harmonized other campaign and tie regulations, for instance, by prohibiting ties from accepting contributions from corporations and other business entities. By equalizing the contribution limits for campaigns and ties, Intro 980 will reduce confusion among contributors and elected officials. Generally, we have proposed some technical changes to the bills with council staff. Most important of these are the effective dates that allow the CFB the time necessary to implement these changes. We look forward to working with the council further to address those technical issues as these bills move forward. Finally, we want to thank the board, the committee, for the two resolutions you are considering today. These are especially timely. Tomorrow, NYC Votes will lead more than 200 volunteers to Albany as part of a coalition of community organizations and civic groups to push for legislation that will bring New York's elections into the 21st century. Our Vote Better NY campaign is seeking to convince legislators to pass meaningful election reform this session. We thank the council for your support and advocacy on these issues and invite you to join the effort on social media or in person. Year after year, New York ranks among the least engaged, lowest turnout states in the nation. Earlier this month, we saw many of the reasons why. New York deserves better. First and foremost, our pen and paper voter registration system is outdated and error-prone. We join the call you've raised today to urge legislators in Albany to start to solve this problem by passing the Voter Empowerment Act. More information on these and other reforms, as well as the full range of voter engagement activities we've conducted through our NYC Votes campaign, are included in our annual voter assistance report, which was delivered to the council last week. Thank you for the opportunity to testify here today on this legislation, and I'm happy to answer your questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony and your patience. You are the main event. We've been joined by Councilmember Borelli, who maintains perfect attendance on this committee. However, this is the first time he did not beat me to a hearing, so it is all right. I think I have to start with the elephant in the room, which is just the overall question of Can you share some evidence of how campaign finance reforms in this system is actually reducing corruption, given everything we're reading in the New York Post every day?
Well, no matter how strict you make rules, no anti-corruption program will completely ever eliminate corruption. It can make it more difficult, and it can make it more likely to be discovered, and I think that's what our system does. What our system does is put more good people in the position that they can be successful. The matching funds program makes it possible for more good people to run competitive elections, empowers candidates to rely on small donor contributions, and our disclosure requirements mean that anyone can access the information they need to hold elected officials to a high ethical standard.
And so along those lines, with regards to Introduction 985, what evidence do you have that bundling by those doing business with the city is an issue? And a question I received by one of our viewers is, in your testimony, you indicate a figure of approximately $203,000, which led to matching claims of $1.2 million in 2013. What was the total amount bundled by people in the doing business database? So two separate questions.
I don't know if I have the exact number of the total amount that was bundled, because we are focusing on the matching funds issue. I can get that information.
Perfect. And just what evidence do you have that bundling by those doing business with the city is an issue?
Well, it's just, there are large numbers. I mean, as I said in my testimony, of the top 10 bundlers in the 2013 election, six of them were in the doing business database. So they are bundling large amounts of money. And this would reduce the, I guess not bonus effect, but sort of the additional effect of matching those contributions with public money.
So along those lines, I took some time to do some analysis of your transparent database, which I thank you for. I spend a lot of time in it. And noticed that there were folks like related companies, this particular individual from related companies, Jay Kriegel. He bundled $111,045, claimed $3,575 in matching claims, which indicates these were pretty big checks that were coming in. And the city ended up paying out $21,450. Which comes out to about 16% on a total raise for candidates of $132,495. Is that one instance? Are there other instances that you can point to where lobbyist dollars, people doing business, have their dollars matched and have their voice amplified?
Well, I mean, that is the number that I gave in the $203,000 amplified to $1.2 million.
Right. I think along the same lines, another example would be a lobbyist, Michael Wallows, bundled $272,465, had $8,225 in matching claims for a public funds payment of $49,350, which meant that this one individual was able to claim that they had raised $321,815 after bundle, and of that, 15% came from taxpayer dollars. So I guess, is the current system incentivizing bundling? Are the incentives that we're trying to offer for small dollar contributions by mistake or however also incentivizing bundling by lobbyists?
Well, I mean, the amount that has been given, I mean, the doing business law when it was passed did have a very immediate effect on the total amount of contributions that were given by people who were doing business with the city. As I said, it went down to 2%. And so there is a direct relation to the passing the law, the lower limits, and the amount of money that's given by people who are doing business with the city. You're right, there is, I mean, one of the reasons we made this recommendation, that there is still this potential for people to bundle or intermediate contributions and have those contributions matched, and thus amplifying that amount of money. So yes, there is the chance, and that's why we're recommending that this law be changed.
We've just been joined by Councilmember Greenfield. We were beginning to worry about his health. We were about to start calling through the local hospitals to make sure something wasn't drastically wrong for him to miss this opportunity, but I'm guessing he was watching the live stream and waiting for CFB to come up?
Of course, my favorite city agency.
Fair enough, so I'll continue. So along those lines, so for an example, Michael Wallows at Connolly McLaughlin Wallows can only give $400 to mayor, $320 for borough president, or $250 for city council under the law, is that correct?
Yes.
But the way around it is for him to be able to bundle, and those bundles have been matched, but under this change in the law, it wouldn't be matched, and public dollars would not be used to amplify the voice of lobbyists.
That's correct.
Perfect. And has the CFB heard from any lobbyists in favor or against this legislation?
No.
And do we believe that we actually did, good government groups are also lobbyists, so they've self-identified in the back of the room. Let the record reflect that my brothers and sisters at NYPIRG raised their hand. But in terms of the doing business lobbyists that with regard who represent other folks for money, they haven't come out in favor or against. And as far as do you believe that lobbyists who represent others for money have the sophistication and wherewithal to know that they could come out to this hearing to speak in favor or against this legislation?
I assume that they do.
Perfect. And so let the record reflect that we do not have any cards from any lobbyists. The lobbyists have stayed home on this one, and the assumption is hopefully that they are supportive of this legislation. And I believe that they do have the wherewithal to make their voices heard, should they so desire. Well, they're not here in opposition. And then with regards to 985, spouses and family members are not covered by the same limits as those doing business with the city. Is there any concern that notwithstanding this legislation, individuals will find ways to have their funds matched, or that bundling will somehow be driven underground?
I think we're trying to do incremental, approach. Well, I guess we'll look into see if there's been a change, if the law is passed, and research that to see if there is that kind of activity.
With regard to introduction 986, which would change the payment deadline, what evidence, anecdotal or otherwise, do you have that the current payment cycle is a problem for candidates?
Well, I mean, we feel that, as I said in my testimony, both in terms of the ability to budget more rationally and also to fix problems earlier in the election cycle, that's why we made this proposal. It's, knowing in June that you have a problem that might cause you not to get paid is a lot, it gives you more time before the heat of the election starts in August, September for the primary. It gives you enough time to rectify those problems.
Following up on this early payment legislation, in your time with the CFB, have you ever seen candidates who filed to become candidates, but then without a public funds payment, without substantial fundraising activity, end up trying to petition on the ballot, but then end up not making it onto the ballot following challenges? And do you think that this early payment could actually help people with the legal funds they need to survive a ballot challenge? We're joined here by the Gotham Gazette, and they've done some coverage on the, they have a specific term for it, but they've got a series of articles on people being the Dick, do you know what's the term you folks are using? It's the ballot box, something or other. But anyway, the blocking the ballot, as it were.
Well, I have two statements. Well, based on our analysis, and in 2013, there would have been no candidate who had met the threshold by the May 15th filing that would have was knocked off the ballot. So that's just empirical. Another point to note is that you can't use public funds for ballot litigation, so it's not a qualified expenditure, so that is also important to note. Also, the changes to the ballot petitioning process that were passed by the city through the city charter amendment in 2010 made it significantly easier for candidates to petition onto the ballot.
Thank you. So I think that is helpful for folks to know who are in the business of knocking other folks off the ballot. that the public monies couldn't be used to do that. That's slightly disappointing for me to learn today, but I think we should have more people on the ballot, and I think democracy does not work when you only have one person to vote for, quote unquote. Mm-hmm. With regards to introduction 1101 on behalf of, 1001 on behalf of Councilmember Williams, and this legislation would require disclosure of entities that own entities that do business with the city, which of course the entities that own the other entities do not have to disclose, let alone are not subject to the doing business restrictions. Would you support an expansion of the legislation to not only require disclosure for entities or individuals who own 10% of companies that do business with the city, but to also limit their contributions?
I mean, we'd have to discuss how that would work, but I think we're open to that.
Great. And are there any examples of entities that own entities with the city or individuals that own entities that do business with the city? Are these shell companies, or are these people doing business as a matter of course?
So Mr. Freeman likes to always use this example when he talks about it, so I'll use this example, that the person who owns our building that our office is in is SL Green, but Stephen Green, the owner of that company, is not currently in the doing business database because of these kinds of the way the reporting works. Okay. That's an example.
Thank you. That is a first round of questions from me. You have questions from Councilmember Lander, followed by Councilmember Greenfield, and Councilmember Borelli, and then we'll go on to second round.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thanks to you and your staff and the board and your team in general for your work. To have this team of people that diligently look at the law and keep helping us find ways to close loopholes and make it better makes a big difference. As you know, I'm a longtime fan and have both sponsored legislation to strengthen the law and done amicus briefs in some of the lawsuits that have helped defend it. To me, I think the most significant thing, I'm proud to be a co-sponsor on most of the pieces of legislation on today's calendar, and appreciate your feedback on them in detail. I really do think that the strengthened restrictions around doing business are the most important things we're talking about today, and in some ways, one of the great features of our law. So first, what I want to do is just make sure I remember the numbers on, you cited the 2% number. Beforehand, as I recall, it was something like 35-36% of prior to our doing business restriction. Well, let me just ask it like that. Prior to our doing business restriction, what percent of contributions were from doing business with the city?
So before the restrictions were passed in 2007, in those previous two elections, it was roughly about 20-25% of all contributions to all candidates came from people who are doing business with the city. And so what you saw afterwards is that number dropped sharply to the point where in the most recent election, 2013, that number is about 2%. Now, what you're seeing with bundling is kind of bundling, is sort of at the levels that it was at before the pay-to-play restrictions came in. About 25% of the overall money bundled in the last election came from bundlers who were doing business with the city at some point during the election cycle.
And as I recall, the percent in city council races was even higher. It may be that percent in the 30s that I'm remembering was specifically looking at city council races.
I can't break it down by office off the top of my head. I'm happy to.
I'm pretty sure that the number that doing business contributions into council races prior to the rule was actually up in the 30s. In any case, that's an extraordinary drop, and I just think it's important to underline, if what we think the real core corruption risk is, one of the clear and core goals is to eliminate the pay-to-play incentives, and if that's what we want to focus on in response to what we're reading in the newspapers, it seems to me the first thing to do is to remember that laws can be effective and that we significantly pushed pay-to-play money, doing business money, out of the system in this very sensible, concrete way. And we ought to underline it a few times and then figure out what we got to do next to take it further. So I'm a co-sponsor and a proud supporter of 985, but I guess I want to ask about the things that we could do to make it go further. Are there things that we could do to further, it's useful to eliminate the match. But I'd love to know if there's things you think we could do that could go further. Obviously, we brought the limit down on what kind of contribution those folks can give. We not only eliminated the match, we reduced the cap from $2,750 to $250. I speak in council race numbers. Obviously, you can translate those into citywide or borough-wide race numbers. Could we further restrict? Could we say that if you're doing business, you can't bundle at all, or you can't bundle contributions bigger than the ones that you can give? Or do you think those would run afoul of Citizens United?
I mean, I think we'd have to look into the constitutionality of both those proposals. I mean, I think there are merits to them, but I think we'd have to be careful.
Okay. And I mean, I think this is why we're lucky to have you and your team. So I guess, I don't know, you know, Ben's staff have probably already beat me to the LS as they did on quite a few of these, but I don't really care who's the lead. I would like to explore whether we could, you know, both in the council, and I'd appreciate if you would look at that as well, whether we could, you know, eliminate bundling or just say you could bundle no more than the contributions you're allowed to make. And it sounds like you had given some thought to the questions of spouses and family members. Which again, you know, on the one hand, I don't want to restrict people's family members from doing their own genuine politics. On the other hand, it's a pretty straightforward loophole to have your spouse bundle the same contributions that you couldn't. Have you looked into whether those would survive constitutional challenge?
Well, you know, there was those kind of provisions in the lobbying law that was passed before the doing business law. So. But we can look into that. I don't know how, you know, extending them, how that would work. And again, I mean, obviously, spouses are separate people and have, so I mean, there is a very, you know, a question of limiting people's political expression when they are not the same person as their spouse.
Absolutely, and these can be tough issues. You, of course, don't wanna limit people's abilities to express independent political positions of their spouses, and you don't want to leave a giant loophole open where folks whose work together is so straightforward that it's obvious what's happening in any case. You, in response to the chair, I think got at an issue that I was going to raise, so I'll give him precedence on that one. But obviously this owner, you know, I'm pleased to be a co-sponsor on Councilmember Williams' bill about ownership of entities, but it seems that as disclosure doesn't mean that much if we don't take the next step also. If the whole point is to identify the doing business interests, would there be any reason, can you think of any reason we wouldn't want to restrict ownership entities of entities doing business in the same ways that we restrict the entities themselves?
I think that, I mean, there might be some technical administrative issues because, you know, creating the systems, I think that Mr. Berger spoke about that in the administrative, when he testified for the administration, about creating that information and then implementing it, you know, for the 2017.
And we grappled with this on the independent disclosure, independent expenditure disclosure law as well, trying to figure out how many, you know, nested loops you can cover. But it looks like
I would just add to the administrative piece that the database is not actually in our control, right? It is maintained by the Mayor's Office of Contract Services, and so there is some level of coordination required to make sure that the right people are being covered, and so on. So I think that adds a layer.
And this goes to my last question, which I think is starting to veer outside of what's on today's calendar, but the question of folks in the doing business database and solicited contributions by not-for-profits to charitable organizations seems to me another thing we might want to think about. And I'll be honest, I've done that. I raise money for like PTAs in my school district, and I'm allowed under the current rules, though I couldn't solicit contributions in excess of the $250 or matchables for my campaign account. You know, if I'm fundraising for a PTA or another good cause, I'm allowed without limit to solicit people in the doing business database. That's also your understanding of the law?
Yes, I think so. I mean, I'm not an expert on the conflicts law, but I believe
that. That would be conflicts law restriction, not campaign finance law restriction, right? Because you guys cover campaign finance registered committees and things that relate to conflicts with elected officials would have to be handled through the conflicts law with COIB, but obviously could relate to that doing business database in the same ways that it's not your database, that's a city doing business database.
And there are certainly obviously overlaps between the campaign finance laws and conflict laws in these kinds of areas. So in developing those legislative proposals. We would be.
Are you familiar with any place? I mean, I guess, I think we're out in front in having a doing business database and its deep connections to our campaign finance system. Obviously, compared to the state, it's night and day. I wonder if you are aware of other jurisdictions who have robust doing business prohibitions, a good doing business database, and perhaps we might look to if we want to think about the intersections of that and the conflicts law or how it would relate to our campaign finance or our conflict systems.
Well, many states and other jurisdictions have pay-to-play laws. Of course, New York City's is one of the best in the country because it is the extensive definition of who is doing business with the city. Many of these other jurisdictions cover government contractors and bidders on contracts, and we have a very extensive definition. But there are many, many other jurisdictions that have pay-to-play laws. Connecticut, it's the state of Connecticut, the state of New Jersey, both have pay-to-play laws.
And okay, let me leave it there. There's a lot on this calendar and other folks with questions, so I may come back to you at another point. But thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. And I just to follow up a little bit on what Councilmember Lander said, and I think has been reported well by Aaron Durkin at the Daily News, there is quite a frequent situation where if you look at max contributions to higher offices, that you will see a lot of the same last names, where instead of one person giving $49.50, you will see them, their spouse, their children, their uncles, their aunts, their grandparents, their nieces, nephews, cousins, third cousins, and so on. And they all seem to have the same last name. They all seem to have the same zip code. They all seem to often have relations. And so I think anything we can do there within the confines of the Constitution would be great. Councilmember David Greenfield, now, had you been here for the beginning of the hearing and on time, you would have had a chance to ask questions even before you were ready, like some of your colleagues who were given a chance to ask questions before they were ready.
Sure. The good news, though, is I have no need to name check every reporter in the room because you've already done that. So I thank you, Chair, for making it clear as to who's actually covering this. I didn't realize we could actually ask reporters and good government groups questions while they weren't up here on the panel. So I learned something new today here as well. This is a routine we have going on. Just if you follow the land use hearings, I bust Chair Kallos' chops, and he busts my chops. Yes,
here at GovOps, we have a higher level of decorum.
A higher standard, yes.
It's a little like the good-natured humor of the White House Correspondents' Dinner, where they all pretend to laugh at each other's jokes.
No, I'm actually laughing. I'm certainly laughing. Okay, so just to be clear, you want to restrict the ability of individuals who happen to be related to each other to give contributions to folks?
All that is on the agenda is the eight bills on the agenda.
Oh, okay, no, I heard that. I was curious as an attorney how exactly that would work out, free speech and all that, but.
As you are filling out your conflicts of interest forms before the May 6th deadline, you are being compelled through speech to share how your family earns their income. So there is a lot we can do there, and as has been disclosed, lobbying has restrictions around spouses and family members as well, so.
All right, enough kibitzing for the day. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate your indulgence, and I'm certainly pleased that somehow your hearings seem to go longer than any other committee that I sit on. Intro number 986, I wanted to chat about that for a second. So this would certainly solve a lot of the problems in terms of access, to funds. I'm just curious, right now there seems to be a pretty early deadline for folks to opt into the system. Now for council candidates, for example, that's pretty obvious. Most council candidates want to opt into the CFB system. But in some cases, when you have folks who are running for citywide office, like mayoral candidates, they don't end up qualifying for the matching funds, and they sort of get stuck in the system. Is there a reason why there's an early opt-in? Is there an ability to sort of have it later in the process or to have folks opt out if they don't end up qualifying for matching funds?
Well, there are, I mean, two. The main reason that the deadline is early, or it's as early as it is, and it was at one time even earlier, is to actually make it before, intentionally it falls before the date for petitioning, so that candidates are deciding whether or not they want to be participants, not based on what's going to be on the ballot, but based on their willing, their desire to be in the public matching funds program. And also the law specifically does not allow people who opt into the matching funds program to opt out, because there's no guarantee when you join the program that you will receive public matching funds. So to allow people to opt out at a late date could be problematic, also be based on political considerations rather than your compliance with the law.
Okay, I mean, I'm speaking specifically about the folks for citywide offices, because obviously there's a much more difficult threshold, right? I mean, do you remember last time how many folks actually ran for citywide offices who opted in, and how many actually ended up getting the public funds?
Well, for citywide offices, there are often large numbers of people who run for citywide office. I think that people who opted into citywide office versus who received public funds, I'm not sure. It's probably in our post-election report. We can look it up as we sit here if you want.
No, just my recollection recollection is that a lot of them don't get the matching funds.
Probably about two or three, I think. Candidates did not qualify who were participants, but I'm not sure. I'd have to look it up. Do you know?
I mean, I don't have the exact number to quote to you off the top of my head. There's a number of candidates generally who are who come in and always qualify, the quote unquote serious candidates. There are going to be a number of candidates at the bottom who may not take the election quite as seriously and don't really make a solid enough effort to qualify. And I think in every election cycle, there are a couple who are kind of in the middle, people who may have some experience who don't quite raise the matching claims that are required to qualify for public funds.
So the concern in waiting would be what for those kinds of candidates? The concern of having a later date, what would that concern be in terms of gaming system? Can you just explain that, please?
It's basically so that people can make their decisions based on their desire to be in the public matching funds program. Also, most of the disclosure statements happen before the opt-in date. You know, there's only, the opt-in date is the June of the election year, so most citywide candidates have done fundraising well in advance of that. And if you have not, The thresholds are well known, and we educate the candidates about them. So, and they are significant to demonstrate the amount of money that's going to be given to them. It's to show that you're a serious candidate. That's why all the thresholds exist in the system.
Got it. Okay. So if we want to know who's running for mayor, we look early on at how much money they're raising. Duly noted. Let me ask this question regarding Intro 990, regarding the PAC registration. So remind me again why we have separate PAC registrations in the city and the state? Because I know a lot of people get accidentally tripped up over this, right? You know, I'm sure you see this as well. Folks think that they're registered PAC in the state, and you know, if folks are intentionally evading the rules, I want you to slam them, obviously. But if it's an accident, I certainly don't want to see that happen. So can you just remind me why we have separate registrations in the city and the state in terms of the PACs?
Part of the registration process in the city, it requires the PAC to indicate that they will not be giving contributions from money that's prohibited, so like corporate contributions, so that in the state, because corporate contributions are allowed on the state, doesn't have the same kind of registration requirement.
But, I mean, once again, just thinking out loud, right? In theory, you could have that rule and still enforce the rule without requiring PACs to register, right? I mean, the rule would still exist. The law still exists. You can't, right? Because right now, if you have a PAC that has commingled funds, where you have funds from corporations and LLCs and individuals, they can still register in New York City. They just have to tell you that they're separating those funds. Is that correct?
Correct. Yes, that's correct.
Okay, so that rule would still exist, I guess is what I'm saying.
I mean, it's something we could look into. I mean, it's not, I haven't really spent a lot of time thinking about the, I mean, I understand that it is sometimes confusing for people. I do understand that. But the idea of how we would achieve that commitment that you're not giving corporate money without the registration. I think we could think about that.
I just think it's something that we see a lot, that PACs get tripped up over this, right, where they think that they're registered in the state and they think they can contribute in the city, but they can't because they actually have to re-register in the city. And I think they actually have to re-register every cycle. Am I correct about that as well or no?
Correct, yes. But we send a notice telling them.
What's the reason for that? Why can't you just register once and just, you know?
Because the information, you know, about the owner, the board and such might change over the course of 4 years. But we do send notices to all the people who are registered in the previous cycle asking them if they want to re-register.
Got it. Okay, great. Thanks very much.
Thank you. I just want to, in the interest of fairness, I did not recognize one media source, and I did want to apologize. David Greenfield has his weekly radio show on 6:20 a.m., 7 p.m. Next episode will be on May 5th. What is the topic?
I think we're going to talk about long-winded council hearings in the New York City Council. I'm going to be extending invitations to chairs later this week.
And how long was your MIHCQA hearing?
I think it was 2 days, actually.
There you go. We have not gotten to 2 days yet.
It sure seems like conversations about pay-to-play, campaign finance, and corruption sells papers these days, so maybe you should put that on the air and see if you...
Well, listen, absolutely. We'd love to have it. I'm extending an invitation to both the Chair Kallos and Chair Lander to come and talk about corruption on my radio show this week. We'd love to have you both on the air, and we'd certainly be happy to have that. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Does anyone else have any other questions?
So I have one piece of information for you, Chair Kallos, you asked about. So in 2013, intermediaries who were doing business with the city were responsible for bundling $2.75 million out of a total of about $11 million overall. Just so you have those figures.
Wait, can you guys repeat that again?
So 2013 election, $11 million total reported as bundled to all campaigns. Of that 11 million, 2.75 came from bundlers who were doing business with the city.
Just for order, I'm sorry, Mr. Chair, can I? Just for order of magnitude, what were the total contributions, like, so we can know how much was bundled?
Now we're going to have to turn to this report.
I'm sorry, I'm just trying to understand the order of magnitude. $2.5 million out of 11 million is a whole lot, but if that's out of a much, much larger...
It is in the tens of millions. I'm not going to hazard a guess off the top of my head. I'm happy to share as soon as I can share it.
Yeah.
Okay.
$11 million is a much smaller number than the total amount of contributions in the 2013 election.
Okay, so in the 20% of the bundled contributions, but probably in the single digits of total contributions.
Yeah.
Bundled doing business. All right. Yeah. We can get these numbers afterwards, obviously.
Well, I know that number. It's 2%. 2% of the contributions came from people who were doing business with the city. That, I know, is that number. What the total amount of contributions were. Here, let's see. It involves math.
Is it between 50 and 60 million?
It involves math.
Let's say that.
50 and 60 million total contributed, 11 million of that bundled, 2.5 million of that bundled by folks doing business.
Yes.
Okay, so 5-ish percent of total contributions. Okay. Thank you.
Back to David for a quick follow-up, if he promises to be nice.
I certainly do, and I actually have noted before, and I think it's worth mentioning as well, that one of the great things about this council, as opposed to other jurisdictions, I'm not going to name names, is that we actually have a good government advocate is actually now chairing our committee here that does oversight on government operations. So that's certainly a huge achievement over here, and so we appreciate the work that you do, Chair Kallos. So I just have one final question as we're talking about doing business. I actually have opted, since I've run for office, not to accept any contributions from folks who do business with the city. Why isn't that the rule? I mean, you know, $100, $300, $400, why do we let them give anything, right? The general concept is that if you're doing business with the city, there is some sort of inherent conflict, and it certainly adds up to a significant amount of money.
Well, I think the state of Connecticut tried to do that, and that was determined to be unconstitutional.
Okay, there you go. You see, both me and Chair Kallos are frustrated by constitutional regulations. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
sorry. For the record, the Gotham Gazette article is on ballot bumping. That was the term of art that they coined. With regard to...
Are you going
to
hashtag that on your Twitter account? And did we get your Twitter account on the, for the record yet or no?
You know my Twitter account?
Is
I know yours.
At Ben Kallos?
It is at Ben Kallos. And what is yours? I was just looking at it.
Oh, you knew mine, but I knew yours by heart, for the record.
It's at NYC Greenfield, and it is not spelled the regular way. It is spelled green as in the color.
Yeah, that's how I spell my name. Greenfield.
Fair enough.
The reporters are never coming back, by the way, just so that you know. This is the end. This is the apex of having reporters at your hearings. I hope you enjoy it while it lasts. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. In terms of the voter guide, which is one of the bills that was one of the less controversial bills that we have here today, introduction 988, how much do you it cost to produce the voter guide? How much do you anticipate saving if you have an opt-out option? And would this opt-out option also be helpful in terms of other legislation we're considering, such as printing in multiple languages?
Well, I don't have an exact number for how much we would save with the opt-out, because it's hard to know how many people would decide to opt out. The voter guide, I usually have this number. I think it's about, it costs about $8 million to produce the voter guide a year in a citywide election year.
Okay. And I think that's all the questions we've got. David, last chance.
I really appreciate the work that the CFP does, and I do think it's worth mentioning that you know, we take a lot of hits here in the city of New York, and there certainly has been a lot of coverage and scrutiny, but we do, and we are proud, and we are firm that we have the best matching funds campaign finance system in the world, and in large part that's due to the professional staff at the Campaign Finance Board, and we want to thank you for the work that you do, and we're very grateful for that, so thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, you're excused. Our next panel is Gene Rushnoff from NYPIRG, Dick Dady from Citizens Union, Prudence Katz from Common Cause, Dominic Morrow from Reinvent Albany, and Rosemary Shields from League of Women Voters. This is all the cards we've got. This is our good government panel. We thank everyone for their patience. And if anyone would like to appear before the council in an official manner where they can receive questions from council members and even the public who may submit it, now is the time, specifically if you are a lobbyist who's paid by special interest to represent yourself before the city or state. Going once, twice, three times, if our distinguished panel of good government advocates and admittedly good government lobbyists could... give testimony about why these lobbyists might support limitations on bundles that they might engage in.
Have any of them ever bundled cash? Can we ask them that question?
You can ask them whatever you
want.
Oh,
okay. Just curious.
They'd like to make a big entrance. Clearly.
Whoever would like to go first, please decide amongst yourselves.
I think we ought to have the dean of the delegation go. Gene Rushnoff. Would be my vote.
All right. That's very nice. And the luck is I'll be very brief. I'm Gene Rushnoff with the New York Public Interest Research Group, and we thank the chairman for his leadership on these many campaign finance and good government reforms and his great staff. And it was great that Henry Berger came today and expressed the administration's support for these reforms. I just basically have two points to make. One has been made many times before, but I'll make it briefly, which is we're part of a process that began over 25 years ago of making the city's campaign finance law the best in the nation. It's been amended many times over, requiring debates, requiring disclosure of people who didn't participate. When we had a mayor who said he didn't want to participate because he didn't want to take public funds, you changed the law so that he could do that if he wanted to, and he still didn't want to. And a 6-to-1 match, and you look at this, and it's no mystery why this law has been so successful. And then on the legislation before you, clearly the most important piece of legislation is Intro 985. It gets at what has been a real loophole and a problem in the law. I was around 10 years ago when the council debated this. This issue was 10 years old. They made a mistake in
2006 and did not adopt this provision. And your question, Chairman Kallos, what will the figures be for bundlers and for what I would call influence peddlers, people who work for large businesses, who gather money for those businesses. Anyway, you know, you can debate, you can try and figure out what where we are now, but for the next election cycle, the one we're in, it's going to be bigger, substantially bigger. The fundraisers, they learn their lessons. Campaign money is like water, and it finds ways to get around, and you've got to constantly be vigilant in making sure that you've figured out what the possible loopholes are. I would be astonished if this council were not to vote this piece of legislation in. We live in a time of people's cynicism and despair about government, and the only ones who would benefit from this law not passing are those special interests, whether related was mentioned. There are a host of former city employees or city commissioners who are bundlers and who, and I think they have every right to go out and solicit money from the public. They just don't have a right to use our public tax dollars to amplify their voice. We have nothing against them expressing their views, but, you know, take your hands out of my pocket. That's where we are, and I think the civic community is very united on this point. So I kept to my brief time.
Thank you.
What is it doing? You just missed the wall again.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. My name is Prudence Katz. I'm the Research and Policy Manager for Common Cause New York. We are a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization founded to serve as a vehicle for citizens to make their voices heard in the political process. Accordingly, ensuring that our elections are accessible, well-administered, and fair is part of our core mission to promote civic engagement and accountability in government. Over the past few weeks, a steady drumbeat of rumors, leaks, investigations, and accusations have swirled around the handling of New York State campaigns and party committees. I bring this up in today's testimony because I want to first congratulate New York City and the New York City Campaign Finance Board and how far we have come in the administration of accessible and clean local elections. But as we have heard today, there is still room for improvement, and the bills before the council all go towards plugging in the numerous holes that still exist. Common Cause New York is in favor of all the bills and resolutions that are here before today's hearing, but I want to take the time to focus on three that will go a long way towards eliminating the potential of or the appearance of corruption. Intro 985A, Intro 990, and Intro 1001. As we've heard a lot before, Intro 985A will eliminate the possibility of matching public funds, any contribution to a candidate for a local New York City office that is bundled by a lobbyist or person who has or may have business dealings with the city. This robust regulation that already exists for eliminating matching funds in terms of people who just directly give money has had a large impact. In 2001, doing business individuals made up 25.2% of the total contributions, with a figure of almost 12 million. And fast forward to the 2013 election, and the numbers are dramatically lower. Only 2%, or around 1.3 million, out of the total contributions came from people doing business with the city. But there is still a huge exploitable hole that needs to be plugged by Intro 985. Specifically, we've heard there are no restrictions on intermediaries or bundlers who do business with the city. And Jade Kriegel, the lobbyist for related companies, is a classic example of exactly how this loophole works. Passing Intro 985 will tighten this obviously gushing spigot of public money to local candidates. In that same vein, Common Cause New York urges the passing of Intro 1001, a bill that obviously enhances the strength of the Doing Business database by adding the names of any businesses or organizations that have at least a 10% ownership stake in an entity that does business with the city. At the moment, we only have the names of individuals that have a 10% ownership stake. Finally, passing Intro 990 would prohibit all candidates, even those who are not registered with the city's public matching fund program, from receiving funds from political committees not registered with the New York City's Campaign Finance Board. New York City's campaign finance system is seen as an example for municipalities across the country and within our own state. Let's both stamp out the possibilities of pay-to-play and strengthen the voice of the everyday people of New York City by passing Intro 985, Intro 1001, and Intro 990. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Dominic Morrow, staff attorney for Reinvent Albany. My organization normally keeps an eye on Albany and does not testify on New York City ethics and anti-corruption issues, but this is no ordinary moment. We support all of the bills being considered today, in particular Intro 985A, the bill addressing bundling by people doing business with the city. However, along with urging you to pass all of these bills, we also urge council to consider much larger reforms. We're testifying because watchdog groups like ours have long considered New York City government much cleaner than New York State's. Unfortunately, the new scandals embroiling the mayor suggest it may be possible for an elected official to circumvent the city's anti-corruption systems and essentially take money in exchange for political favors without breaking the law. We believe New York City's campaign finance system is being profoundly undermined by lax enforcement of lobbying regulations and by the use of nonprofit groups controlled by the city or its elected officials as destinations for contributions from wealthy interests seeking political favors. Accordingly, we would like the Council and the Committee on Government Operations to confer with the Mayor's Office and the Campaign Finance Board about major reforms that would address these issues. We have two suggestions. First, the Mayor, Comptroller, Public Advocate, Council, and agency heads should not be able to solicit contributions for nonprofit groups that they effectively control. Until this nonprofit backdoor is closed, city officials, especially the Mayor, will have a huge incentive to use nonprofits to evade the limits that keep elected officials from soliciting huge contributions. Second, lobbying rules have to be strengthened and lobbying enforcement transferred from the city clerk to the campaign finance board. It simply does not work to have lobbying rules enforced by the city clerk, who is a political appointee of the city council. A strong lobbying enforcer could step in to preempt problematic conflicts, such as firms working for both the mayor and for clients who want favors from him. Thank you for your time and for the opportunity to testify.
Good afternoon. Can you? I'm Rosemary Shields with the League of Women Voters of the City of New York, and I want to thank the committee for having us here today. And basically, I want to say ditto what has been said by Mr. Roshanoff and Common Cause of New York. You have my testimony. I don't necessarily have to read because into Intro 985A, Intro 1001, Intro 990, we're all for it. I was very happy, very encouraged by Assemblymember Kavanaugh coming in, because what the League of Women Voters wants to take every opportunity that we can to remind the council about instant runoff voting. We want you to be very familiar with Irv. We want you to use his first name, but we are asking, especially with all the intricacies and of Intro 987, we're just going to keep pushing for Irv, and hope that the council continues with that. And we're all for the flexibility of the voter guide. And I also just want to point out that the League of Women Voters of New York State gave me the memorandum in support of Assemblymember Kavanaugh's 5972. And we want to thank Chairman Kallos for putting through this resolution. We support that. Thank you very much.
Unlike my colleague, Councilmember Greenfield, this is actually one of our shorter hearings. Anyone who wants to read their full testimony, please do not feel rushed by David. You waited 2.5 hours here. He was in his office watching the live stream. There's no complaint. So anyone, please don't feel rushed. There is no rush. We have all the time in the world, and your voice is important.
How much time, Chairman?
As much as you like.
This room is reserved until midnight, so.
Thank you very much.
We'd like for you to, if you can go for another 7 hours and 33 minutes.
Is that a call? A filibuster then?
Their chair would be very grateful for that.
I'm not sure if you saw in the Passover Haggadah.
And the chair's staff week. Would be really thrilled as well. In case you're curious about the turnover rate in Councilmember Kallos' office.
We actually have knock on wood, the lowest turnover in the council. Paul's been with me since 2013.
Well, nice.
If you saw on the Passover Haggadah, can we let our good government folks testify?
if we could interrupt.
Yes. Please.
My name is Dick Dady. I'm the executive director of Citizens Union, and I thank the two remaining members of the City Council who are seated here before us to listen to our testimony. I do have to say that it's always of great concern to us that our opinions, though widely solicited, are not necessarily heard by the members of the council who participate at the beginning of these hearings. And that, to us, is, or at least to Citizens Union, is a little distressing when we see a number of council members get up and leave when it's time for us to come forward with our ideas. Because we are, the keeper of the public interest in a way that others are not. And I join my colleagues here today in supporting all that is before you today. You have our written testimony from Citizens Union in front of you. I want to thank the chair for convening this hearing, and thank you, City Council Member Greenfield, for being here as well. These are strange times in our city and state when it comes to the effect of money on our politics and on our democracy. All of these bills get at it in some way, helps to strengthen this system that my colleague Gene Rushenoff spoke about and who is instrumental in creating. Over 25 years ago. I've been pleased to be a part of the efforts over the last 12 years to improve this system, and as is the case, every 4 years we have an opportunity to strengthen the system and make it even better, and these bills do that. I do want to point out the very intense need for the council to not only consider Intro 985, but to pass 985. It is the heaviest lift of all these bills, but it should be the number. But it also should be the number one priority of this council. New Yorkers, I think, are getting to a point of utter disgust with the way in which our democracy is practiced and our government is run. The influence of money in our political system is obscene, and this bill, Intro 985, would get at. In a much more significant way than in any of these other bills, the influence of money in our system. I was with Gene Rushenoff 10 years ago when we advocated for this bill initially, and we were pleased to see that those who have business before the city had their contributions limited to a particular level, far less than what other individuals in this city would be allowed to contribute. But we knew at that time that the power to influence public policy moved from those who could give to those who could raise. And this bill here attempts to, or would get at this issue of limiting the influence of those who raise money on behalf of these candidates. It's a commonsensical, much needed piece of legislation. Even more so, given the rising scandals, the growing crime wave of corruption that we see here in Albany, but now it seems to have reached down into New York City. Many of these allegations remain just charges, but they have not yet been fully investigated and handled by our legal system. But we cannot walk away from the fact that what may be legal is also unethical. Huge amounts of money were raised by the mayor's political team to influence the outcome of elections. And while this bill itself does not deal directly with that issue, I think it would be incumbent upon the City Council to rise to this moment and take on this challenge and really push through the most meaningful piece of legislation that could improve our city's campaign finance program, Intro 985. We need to continue to take money out of the system. The City Council has done that for 25 years now. This is an opportunity for you to, you know, help complete the job by passing 985. All these others are very important, but this is the most important. And I would very much hope that the council would do that with a very strong vote. Let me just turn to one other thing that I saw on the live stream about online voter registration. It was cutting in and out, so I didn't get the entire discussion on it. But you know about the Attorney General?
I wasn't the only one who had trouble with the live stream. I'm glad to know that.
But the Attorney General of the state of New York, Eric Schneiderman, last week released an advisory opinion, prompted in part by Citizens Union's inquiry a couple years ago, making online voter registration now possible. He ruled that digital signatures would be acceptable for the purposes of voter registration, making the practice of online voter registration possible. It's an advisory opinion, and what is needed now is a software application that will make it happen. I mean, there's still a requirement that you have to print off and deliver or mail the applications, but for the voter, if they can just go to go online on their computer and complete the application and have someone else handle it for them as a intermediary, not to confuse intermediary with the kind of intermediary we're talking about today, but this is a significant step forward, his ruling, and I think we should capitalize on it and try and move legislation forward that ensures that New Yorkers can now actually practice this issue of online voter registration. So I just wanted to add that to my organized comments here today.
Thank you very much for your patience, for being here today, and for having near perfect attendance at my hearings. I think your attendance for Citizens Union rivals is actually better than most of the members of my committee, so thank you.
I'm glad you pointed that out, not us.
I think your sister paper, Gotham Gazette, did in-depth coverage on attendance rates at hearings. So I guess one thing is, and this was self-identified by folks who could not see off camera, but please identify whether or not you are a registered lobbyist on this panel, if you can identify for the record.
Dick Dady, Executive Director of Citizens Union, is a registered lobbyist and has been a registered lobbyist since 1991.
Next.
Gene Rushenoff, a registered lobbyist for the New York Public Interest Research Group, I believe circa 1981 or 82.
Thank you. Anyone else registered? At League of Women Voters, she would be a volunteer, and so that doesn't qualify for the lobbying because she is not compensated for her time. Is that correct? You're not compensated?
Correct.
Okay.
Dominic Morrow, Reinwood Albany, registered lobbyist.
Vince Katz, Common Cause New York, registered lobbyist since 2015.
And all four of you as registered lobbyists support not having bundles that you put together matched.
We're willing to give it up.
Yeah, we are.
And
how many of them have bundled money?
Huh?
How many of them have bundled money?
Feel free to ask that question.
I did not even know that my colleagues even stood the chance of actually raising money for city council candidates, but we don't.
We're nonpartisan. We don't support anyone.
But for the record, we do have a group of lobbyists here who do support a restriction. And
yes, which also proves the point that not all lobbyists are bad people. There are good lobbyists.
And they're also, many of them are sitting here.
And I have not heard any lobbyists in an organized way speak up against this.
I'm pretty familiar with lobbyists who have talked to members. And hope that they would raise this as an issue during the debate.
Can you speak into the microphone, please? Sorry.
I have talked to lobbyists who have been talking to council members, not publicly, not on the record. They have no desire to be anywhere near this issue publicly, but they have been weighing in. I've talked to someone.
And in terms of the impact, I read some numbers earlier. But do you think it will have a huge impact? So I think the example that was brought up, I believe it was Common Cause. Which one of you mentioned Jay Kriegel?
I mentioned Jay Kriegel, but he had been mentioned a lot. So
fair enough. So Jay Kriegel, he gave he bundled $111,045, and he only claimed $3,575. He got $21,450. Dollars and claimed matching funds for his candidate for a total of $132,000. So that's only 16% public match. Is that, and that's just because all these dollars are big $49.50 checks. These are not small dollar contributions. Do you think that this will have a huge impact?
It's not just the amount. It's really the principle behind it. That registered lobbyists who are seeking to influence the decisions of our city government are using our taxpayer dollars to amplify their influence. That is the guiding principle that Citizens Union and I think others may stand behind. Regardless of the amount of money that goes to match some of these contributions, it's not the amount. It's the mere principle. We do not support limiting anyone's rightful right to participate, but we oppose their ability to use our taxpayer dollars to amplify their message. That's the real problem.
If I could add, if you want to be a successful influence peddler, you have to be able to peddle something. And the amounts of money are going to get bigger in this election cycle. And they're getting an advantage here that the ordinary New York City resident does not get, who's in part paying for. And lastly, I'd say the hallmark of the Campaign Finance Board is that they are very cognizant about the fact that they're using public tax dollars. And they've gone out of their way to spend them as appropriately, as fairly, as legally as they can. And so it's not good when someone comes around and spreads their money around.
And in terms of this, some have criticized that this will just force things underground. Is there a value to lobbyists or people doing business to be able to say, look, I'm an intermediary, I raised, in the case of a lobbying firm like Michael Wallows, where he raised $272,465 with $49,350 bundled in from public matching, is there a certain reason they would want to be reported as an intermediary? Is there a likelihood that next cycle we just won't see this person's name or another similar person's name in because we've driven it underground, even though everyone knows with a wink and a nod that that person raised that money for the person?
Clearly, the individuals who do this, it's part of their jobs. They reach out to customers, to connections, and they are able to say, I have $30,000 I could give you, I have $50,000 I could give you. And to the candidates, that, you know, means a lot. So I would say, you know, does it overwhelm the system? You can't argue that. But does it create a bad taste in the mouth of the elected officials and candidates and people concerned about government? It certainly doesn't help encourage them to believe that their government makes decisions entirely upon the merits.
And forgive the question and my seeking to elicit your testimony, but as a lobbyist, what is your threshold? How much can you give to a city council member?
Well, again, we're nonpartisan, so I've never.
But a lobbyist is restricted to 250. But you just said that lobbyists are saying that they can give 30 or 50,000.
Yeah,
so help me understand how somebody who is limited to $250 can go to a candidate and say I can give 50,000, and the corrupting influence that might have. That's something that I think is worth entering into the record.
The math is pretty clear. The city council and the mayor voted to limit the contributions from people who do business with the city to $450 in citywide races. That was a determination you made about the good effect of limiting them to a relatively modest amount. It wasn't so low that it raised constitutional concerns, but it was a meaningful limit. Now the same person can go out and talk to a whole bunch of people in the city, raise contributions and deliver them to the candidate, and they basically get credit for it. So an individual who was limited to $450 is now giving, you listed some of the numbers, $100,000, substantial sums of money that used to be seen during the heyday of the 1980s when you'd have people giving this size contribution. So it comes from different sources. They had to work to get it. But it shouldn't be rewarded with public matchability, and I would go one step further and just not allow anyone in the city to bundle contributions above what they're limited to in the law in terms of giving contributions.
And I guess I'm hoping that your organizations might be willing to assist with legal research supporting why that might be constitutional.
Yes, or someone who really knows their stuff.
It may be a consequence of this proposed bill, if enacted into law, that some of these bundled contributions may be driven underground. But that's not a reason not to do it. And because the reason to do it is to ensure that influence peddling is lessened, and that if it is done to evade the law, then I'm sure that the Campaign Finance Board, in its rigorous enforcement of the law, will pay close attention to those who try to do that. I also want to add, when you asked about political contributions, I mean, Citizens Union is a nonpartisan organization, but we also conduct evaluations of candidates and offer our support either in the primary or the general election through our evaluation process by giving a preferred or endorsed status to those candidates. The State Board of Election has ruled that we needed to register as a political committee, which we have done over the past couple of years, and there is a value, though nominal, that is assigned to those candidates that we support based on the cost and the printing and the distribution of our voter's guide.
My last question on this round is just, what is that value? And I'd like to turn it over to David Greenfield for his questions. Do you know how much the nominal value is for the preferred?
It depends. It is varied from year to year, depending upon the number of candidates we support versus the cost of the voters directory and the number that we print.
Thank you.
It's like $100 or so per candidate.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Unlike the chairman, I did not clear my entire calendar today, so I have to run, but I did want to say for your testimony, because it was important, I wanted to thank you for your testimony. I did just want to note for the record, because I think it's important, is that, you know, when we're naming names of lobbyists and bundlers, just for folks watching at home, everything that they're doing is, in fact, legal. We are just saying that we can do better, and I agree, and therefore, I'm asking that you add my name to intro number 985A, and I do. This is why I come to the GovOps hearings. People come to me and they say, why in the world would you volunteer to sit on Ben Kallos's committee? And I say, it's true, there's only four of us, but.
We got new members who
want
to join
new members?
The committee.
So oh, they should seven. Have sent them to me. I would have set them straight. But the answer is you get applause, which you don't get in any other committee. Usually we get booed, especially in the land use world, but we won't go there. Seriously, I want to thank you all for the work that
and
you do.
More of the city, you
we,
get applause.
We appreciate it. And you can actually, you can catch us at some of New York's not-so-fine comedy clubs this summer. When the council's on break, Ben Kallos and I are going to be doing a routine. There will be no covers because we don't think that people will come watch to pay for it, but at least you can join us this summer at our free comedy routine
Catskills.
That we'll keep going. In the Catskills, perhaps, as well. Yes, thank you.
I was thinking this was a little bit like the Honeymooners.
Yes, yes, exactly. Exactly. Thank you all.
Thank you for your support,
nice.
Council member.
Very good.
Thank you, member. Thank you, Council Member Greenfield. With regard to early payment, do you have any concerns with that? Is there any evidence, anecdotal or otherwise, that the current payment cycle is a problem for candidates?
I'm sorry, the door opening up affected my ability to hear you.
With regards to introduction 986 for early payment, is there any evidence, anecdotal or otherwise, that shows that early that the current payment schedule has been a problem for a candidate or two or more?
I think the answer is yes.
We can give you the mic.
We can get back to you with what.
No, I need you to speak into the mic.
You're following, an election cycle doesn't go by where several candidates don't say, I waited so long for the money that by that time it was just too late to move forward with the campaign. So anecdotally, we've heard this.
Any candidates who didn't make matching of concern or?
Well, the most famous example is Sal Albanese, who several years in a row failed to make the threshold and was a very credible and hardworking candidate.
Great. With regard to in terms of early payment and ballot bumping, the CFB has indicated that ballot access is not a qualified expense. Is that something that should be fixed, could be fixed? Is it something that should be left alone? Will this have an impact on ballot bumping and creating a situation where we could actually have more than one person on the Democratic ballot or even on the general election ballot?
What I would say is, and this is one of the reasons why many of our groups have grown to despise the time we spend reading the election law, because it is so terribly complicated. And so you could have someone who is preemptively challenging somebody else to help a third candidate. And the argument was made to us, well, that's a situation where you don't want to put someone at a deficit by, you want them to have access to some money to defend a false attack. And is that true? Does that reflect the reality of elected life? I don't know. I just know it's said to me often.
I would just concur with what Gene has said. We have not thought about whether that should be a qualified expense. I value and trust the judgment of the Campaign Finance Board. But it's probably worthy of consideration as we look forward, as we look down the road in terms of future reforms.
Well, I can tell you that if you any money spent on ballot access counts against your spending limit,
right.
But you can't use public funds for it.
Right.
So it's just one thing versus another, and then perhaps as part.
Maybe there is a rationale to use public funds for that, since it is seen as a.
It's a tough question.
Yeah.
Sometimes there's tough questions here, too.
I mean, we actually support raising the spending cap to begin with.
With regard to introduction 1001 from Councilmember Williams, who I'm hoping is still watching, is there value to knowing about the entities that own entities? Is there value to knowing the individuals behind the companies that do business with the city? Or is having one company that's doing business with the city, should that not be translated to the other companies that own that company or the individuals that own that company?
I think there's a lot of value. I think I might have heard a joke somebody was making about a Russian doll problem potentially, but I think you can see examples, especially in how a real estate entity may give money under an LLC or a smaller subsidiary. And it seems it's separate. We heard earlier from Campaign Finance Board testimony, and I was really surprised that the owner of Essel Green is not listed in the Doing Business database because of, I don't know what kind of firewall. I'm sure it's legal, but definitely intro 1001 seems like a no-brainer.
If I could add, earlier on in the afternoon, you were asking what other things could the council do in groups like ours. I think that Doing Business roster is due for a real overhaul and real close oversight by the council. I think I've talked to people in and around its creation, and it's went as far as it could go under difficult circumstances, but it could be a lot better. So that would be an area I would advise. I don't know if it's ripe for legislation or some other thing, but it should be much stronger than it is.
Would you support expanding 1001 from not only disclosure but also applying the doing business rules to the entities that own entities or the individuals who own entities that do business with the city?
Sunshine is the best disinfectant, electric light, the best police officer. So I would say, exposing it to more disclosure is a good thing.
Okay. Any questions I didn't get a chance to ask? That being said, I'd like to excuse this panel. We don't have anyone testifying against any of the legislation. We thank the good government for being here, as well as members of the public, the Fourth Estate, and the press. Again, I'd like to thank the committee staff, even Councilmember Greenfield. Thank you for joining us. And we got a sponsor out of it. It was worth all of it. We'll do our best to improve the decorum. And I think one piece is, some people say if you put a good apple with the bad apples, the good apple rots. But sometimes, hopefully, it can spread. So thank you. I hereby adjourn this meeting of the Committee on Governmental Operations.
Thank you.